Afternoon, the first item of business this afternoon. Oh, point of order, Rhoda Grant.
I'm not giving you notice of this point of order, but it's just come to light that Kate Forbes has issued a press release commenting on the recommendation of Lauren Creer's report into Highlands and Islands Enterprise. I've checked with Spice and Inspired PQs, but can't find this report anywhere. Could you tell me how all MSPs can have access to the same information, especially something that has been subject to debate in this Parliament?
Thank you very much to Rhoda Grant for raising the point of order. I'm not convinced it's a point of order, but I will take it under consideration this afternoon just to have a look at the matter that Ms. Grant's alluded to. Now, can we move on to the first item of business, which is a debate on motion 4168 in the name of Derek Mackay on the Budget Scotland Bill. I would ask all members who wish to speak in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now, and I call on Derek Mackay to speak to and to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to lead this debate on the Budget Bill for 2017-18. Firstly, I'd like to confirm that I've responded formally to the Finance Committee report on the Budget on Tuesday, and I'd like to commend the Finance Committee and all the subject committees for their constructive approach. Our process in future will continue to adapt to our new powers, and I look forward to seeing the output of the Budget Review Group and to working together with all Members of Parliament to ensure our future processes are fit for our new powers and responsibilities. Presiding Officer, this is a bill of huge importance to Scotland. The decisions we make today underpin the work of our vital public services, our commitment to sustainable economic growth, and the support we provide to communities and individuals across the country. The bill before us today seeks Parliament's approval for an additional £900 million of expenditure focused on the positive vision for Scotland established in our programme for government. That vision is focused on stabilising and growing our economy, empowering our communities, protecting the environment, and promoting equality and improving our public services. The budget we're voting on today includes areas of compromise where, as a minority government, we have worked hard to secure the bill and support for the bill in order to deliver on our commitments and protect Scotland's hard-won social contract. I again thank those who have engaged constructively in those talks and negotiations. As a result, I believe this bill offers a balanced approach that is right for our economy, for jobs and our public services, as well as providing stability and continuity for the public and taxpayers at this time of economic uncertainty. As we debated on Tuesday, the Scotland Act powers mean there is a much more direct link between Scotland's economic performance and the revenues available to fund our public spending. The decisions we make must have economic growth at their heart. In the draft budget, I confirmed our £500 million Scottish Growth Scheme, funding for the city deals, and interventions such as funding for the new innovation and investment hubs in Dublin, London, Brussels, and Berlin. Our support was also confirmed for Aberdeen, Glasgow, and the Highland City deals, which will total over £760 million in the years to come, and we're continuing discussions on Lothian and Tay Cities, as well as the Ayrshire growth deal. We're using all of the economic levers at our disposal, and I'm pleased to confirm further progress today. I have this week confirmed the Scottish Government's formal approval of Fife Council's tax incremental financing scheme, which will enhance the Fife Energy Park and is projected to unlock more than £11 million for the Scottish economy and create more than 220 jobs. As well as taking forward the Fife scheme, I look forward to receiving applications next week for the two fresh TIF opportunities announced in the budget. Overall, in 2017-18, we'll see investment of around £4 billion in key infrastructure projects up and down the country. Projects across our roads and transport programmes, such as the M8, M73 and M74 improvements, the Queen's Ferry Crossing, which will complete this year, the A9, the AWPR and, of course, the Edinburgh to Glasgow Rail Improvement Programme. We'll invest to deliver ambitious targets in affordable housing and invest also in the key area of digital infrastructure, including delivering our commitment to reach 100% broadband coverage. And there are actions to address the climate change challenge, including improving on energy efficiency, reducing bills, creating jobs, and reducing emissions. In addition, to assist the work of our enterprise agencies, our draft budget provided an increase in resources for HIE at stage one, and I've confirmed an additional £35 million for Scottish Enterprise to support loans and equity investments. A fair and competitive business rates regime is, of course, crucial to our economy. The draft budget took a range of early measures ahead of the revaluation, including cutting the tax rate and extending the small business bonus to deliver our commitment to ensure that more than 100,000 businesses pay no rates at all. Of course.
Mike Rumbles.
Would the Minister consider reopening the closing date for the submissions to the Barclay Review on business rates so that, as a result of what's happened recently and your initiatives recently, businesses can actually have another input to that review before they report to the government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm staggered. I've never heard Mike Rumbles make such a contribution, a constructive suggestion in the Chamber before. And I think in that spirit, it's absolutely right that I engage with Ken Barclay and others, actually, to consider further how we look at the issues that require to be addressed as a consequence of those issues. And I'm open-minded, certainly, to do that. I don't think I've also seen Mike Rumble smile at me in the Chamber either. But the additional measures I have taken, warmly welcomed by the business community, will help a further 9,500 business premises as a result of our £660 million of investment in rates relief, which is ensuring that 7 out of 10 premises in Scotland will pay either no or the same or less rates from April the 1st. Now, I do have to say that the Tories and Labour have failed to support any local rates relief schemes so far. They should deliver on their rhetoric and this evening back the government schemes so that we can provide relief across the country.
Ross Thompson.
Thank you for taking an intervention from me, and again, would like to make members aware of my register of interest as an Aberdeen City Councillor. If the SNP had been paying attention, you would know that in Aberdeen, the city has set aside £3 million for business rates relief. Given that they had a less than 24 hours notice to digest your statement, they're looking for more detail on the implications of that for the city and want a local scheme that will help more businesses and other sectors that your proposal doesn't. So will you be true to your word that it's exceptional in the North East? Will you be true to your word that you want a local solution and match the funds that the City Council have already put aside for local relief?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, What hypocrisy from Ross Thompson and the Conservatives, where in SNP-led Aberdeenshire, the Conservatives opposed the local rates relief package, and in Aberdeen, I cut across the party politics to try and engage with Aberdeen City Council, to engage constructively and proactively with that council and the local Chamber of Commerce to listen, engage and deliver. And that is exactly what the government has done. And isn't it interesting that when I acted with all the early measures and then in response to businesses responding to the independent revaluation, the Tories described it as 11th hour actions, and the best they can produce with the same information is consideration of a report at some point in the future. But I will continue to engage with the local authority, but they need to ditch the rhetoric and start coming up with solutions to support businesses in the way that this government has. So immediate interventions to support our economy and also lay the foundations for future growth, and that's why we should invest in our people as well as infrastructure. And as the Chamber is well aware, education is this government's number one priority, and that is why there is such a comprehensive package of investment. The bill delivers £1.6 billion of investment in higher and further education, maintaining at least 116,000 college places, maintaining the £50 million Attainment Scotland Fund, which is targeted, and of course delivering an extra £120 million directly to our schools to address attainment, particularly in our most disadvantaged areas, welcomed by schools across the land. And of course, we're embarking on expanding childcare to the tune of the beginning of £60 million of investment in the first phase of work to expand the provision of early learning and childcare to 1,140 hours by the end of this Parliament. So this package of measures places equality of opportunity right at the heart of this government's approach to Scotland's economy. So I proposed a strong settlement for local government in the draft budget, £120 million for educational attainment, £107 million for additional investment in health and social care integration, increased capital resources, increased access to City Deals funding, and increased revenues from the council tax changes approved by this Parliament. But by working constructively with the Greens to reach agreement, an additional £160 million will be spent by local government at their discretion. The council tax freeze provided much needed relief for household budgets through difficult times. Council tax is on average still lower in Scotland than it is south of the border. And whilst local authorities are able to generate extra revenues through increasing the council tax, it is interesting that some clearly consider that they have sufficient funding to deliver their services without a further council tax increase. These are matters for individual local authorities, but I say again, support for our local services has increased thanks to the actions of this government. And using existing resources wisely, a further public service reform is also necessary. And just one example, recognising the role that councils play in the delivery of housing and social care, I am directing additional funding over the next 2 years to Scotland Excel to develop with Scotland's care providers and registered social landlords enhanced procurement capability that will support plans in these vital areas. We're backing our police and fire services, investing in reform with an additional £25 million for Police Scotland to support their future plans. And to ensure that our NHS is fit for the future, the government is committed to the twin approach of investment and reform. The Health and Social Care Delivery Plan, published shortly after the draft budget, highlights a range of steps to reform and further improve on our health services. Balancing that action with investment which will see NHS revenue spending increase to £12.7 billion in 2017-18, an increase of £120 million above inflation, and the first step towards delivering on our commitment to increase the NHS revenue budget by almost £2 billion by the end of this Parliament. More spending in mental health, more in primary care and GP services. And today, we've confirmed investment of £7.5 million to support the development of GP clusters, which will help GP practices to collaborate on quality improvement, share resources, and develop community health services that are more tailored to the local population. Presiding Officer, I open today by highlighting that voting for this budget of over £900 million of additional investment in our public services, our people and our communities. Whilst this budget delivers on this administration's programme for government, it also responds to requests across this chamber. Supporting businesses in our economy, investing in frontline health and police budgets, expanding expenditure on local authority services, delivering on the living wage, investing in a new social security system, ensuring that no one will pay the bedroom tax, free tuition, expanding early years provision, tackling the attainment gap, improving energy efficiency, increasing in house building, and it supports public services that are free at the point of use, including prescriptions, eye tests, and personal care. Presiding Officer, this budget delivers the best deal for taxpayers and public services in the whole of the UK. A fairer country, a stronger country, and a budget that delivers for our people. I commend this budget to Parliament.
I now call on Murdo Fraser to speak to and move motion 4168.2.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In the budget bill debate 3 weeks ago, I said that the Finance Secretary was a lucky man. He was lucky because he had more resources to deal with than any predecessor in his office. His budget has gone up £500 million in real terms as against the current year. And we know that the Scottish Government's total budget is up even on the previous high of 2010-11. He was also lucky because he has or had an unprecedented range of choices over taxation compared to his predecessors. Well, we didn't realise then, Presiding Officer, just how lucky Mr Mackay was. It turns out he is a far more fortunate man than we even knew at that point. For in addition to the budget presented to Parliament, he has had wads of spare cash just lying around. When the Finance Secretary introduced his budget to Parliament on the 15th of December, he told us This was a fair, well-balanced settlement, that every penny he had was properly accounted for, and that if the opposition parties wanted to propose extra spending in any area, they would have to tell him what cuts they would impose as a consequence. It turns out the Finance Secretary had much more money than he was letting on. Just 3 weeks ago, he produced, as if from nowhere, an additional £185 million in order to secure his budget deal with the Greens. But that was not all, Presiding Officer. Just 19 days after that, on Tuesday of this week, he produced another £44 million to introduce a very welcome rates relief for a number of businesses affected by the current rates revaluation. That's nearly £230 million extra in just a few weeks. Presiding Officer, how I wish I had Mr. Mackay's sofa. It must be the best stuffed sofa in Scotland. Every time he has a problem, he puts his hand down the back of the sofa and he pulls out wads of cash. Who knows what other riches lie down between the seams of the sofa if he just takes time to look. Mr. Stevenson, yes, I'll give way.
Sure, Stevenson.
Will the Tories be voting against the budget tonight and denying businesses across Scotland access to the £44.5 million to which he has just referred? Does he intend to stuff businesses tonight?
Oh. I think if Mr. Stevenson were to ask the business community in Scotland what their view on this budget is, they would give him a very clear response, and it would not be the one that he's looking for. Now, this great wealth that Mr. Mackay has and has identified raises all sorts of important issues. Firstly, Patrick Harvey must now be ruining the day that he and his party sold themselves so short in their budget deal with the SNP. For there was another £44 million to be had, Mr. Harvey, of which you were blissfully unaware. And secondly, the Finance Secretary has undoubtedly created problems for himself in the future. Whenever in coming years he comes to this Parliament and presents his budget and tells us earnestly this is the total sum he has available to spend, no one's going to believe a word he says, Presiding Officer. What we'll be asking is, where is all the extra money that he has squirreled away just waiting to do a deal with the lowest bidder? And there are also serious questions to be raised in connection with this Parliament's budget scrutiny process. As the Fraser of Allender Institute pointed out a few weeks ago, it turns out that this Parliament and its committee's entire budget scrutiny was based on a draft budget that was, at that time, £190 million higher than the one which in Parliament was due course asked to vote upon. And they will say, as they say, in future MSPs may press the government for greater information on the scope to use underspends or changes to non-domestic rates profiling at the outset of the scrutiny process. And they also point out that in the past, underspends have historically been used to boost government spending in subsequent years. This will happen in financial year 2016-17, when underspending for the previous year was utilised with the aim of stimulating the economy in the aftermath of the Brexit vote. But the underspend money this time has been made a central part of next year's budget. And even Mr. Mackay can't spend the same money twice. So as Fraser of Allender say, the case for multi-year budgeting is all the more important, which means that the work going on in the budget review group that has been established is absolutely vital. And what the budget review group needs to look closely at, Presiding Officer, is the issue of budget transparency, as highlighted in the Finance Committee's report on the budget, echoing the concerns of the Local Government Committee, specifically in relation to the lack of transparency around the local government settlement. Now, the Scottish Government's response to this, which was published earlier in the week, says, and I quote, "The increased complexity of the budget process introduces a steep learning curve for all involved." All involved, Finance Secretary. I hope that's an indication that the Finance Secretary himself accepts he must do better in future when it comes to informing Parliament. But this budget process isn't just about balances, it's also about choices. And it remains our view that the Finance Secretary has made the wrong choices in connection with this budget. Because what we should have had is a budget for economic growth. The Scottish economy, as we well know, underperforms the rest of the United Kingdom. Our growth rate is barely one-third of the UK average. Our employment is lower, our unemployment is higher, and our business confidence is much lower. We should have had a budget to boost economic growth and, as a result, boost our tax revenues. That was precisely the point made by the Fraser of Allender Institute last week when they said, With the Scottish Government's budget now increasingly tied to how well Scotland's economy performs relative to the UK, catching up with the UK must be a key priority for government. And there's nothing in this budget today that tells us how they're going to do that. Because instead, the Finance Secretary has presented us with a budget that will do nothing to promote Scotland as an attractive place to do business. He is introducing for the first time an income tax differential that will make Scotland the most highly taxed part of the United Kingdom. He continued with a large business supplement at double the rate applicable elsewhere in the United Kingdom, and his rates of land and buildings transaction tax have led to a situation where he's had to downgrade his forecasts for tax take by some £750 million over the coming years, representing a potential catastrophic loss to the Scottish public finances. Now, we have seen the action taken on the rates revaluation, which we very much welcome insofar as it goes, but it still only affects a minority, a small minority of businesses seeing large increases. And when the Cabinet Secretary earlier talked about local relief schemes, perhaps he wasn't aware, perhaps Mr Swinney didn't tell him, that just yesterday, when the Conservative opposition group on Perth and Kinross Council proposed a local rates relief scheme, it was voted down by SNP councillors on the administration. Of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm afraid I hate to inform the Chamber that Murdo Fraser is actually wrong. I've spoken to the SNP leader of the council, and they're building an augmented scheme, an improved scheme, to do even more for the businesses in Perth and Kinross. That's what's been opposed by the Conservatives.
Murdo Fraser.
Well. What a change since yesterday afternoon. No doubt Mr Swinney's been on the phone to them, yep, telling them to get the rack sorted out in very short order, because they knew they were about to be caught out in this chamber, presiding officer. Well, what a shame, presiding officer, that given all these choices, the finance secretary chose to go in the other direction. He chose to sit down with the anti-business Greens and produce a budget that will entrench our economic underperformance. No, I'm sorry, I have no time just now. Thank you. In the long run, it will be the Scottish public finances that suffer. Because if our economy doesn't grow, our tax revenue won't grow either, and there will be less money to spend on all the things we regard as important. Presiding officer, what we would have done with this budget is keep tax rates competitive with the rest of the United Kingdom, and we would do that knowing that we would raise more revenue in the long run as a consequence, and that's exactly what the business community in Scotland have been calling for. Presiding officer, the Cabinet Secretary's budget not only raises taxes, it still delivers a cut to local government across the country. And this is at a time when a great many Scottish households are seeing substantial council tax rises. So they're being asked to pay more money in taxes, but they're getting poorer public services as a result. What a deal from this SNP government. Presiding officer, that is the budget Mr Mackay is presenting to Parliament. And it is not a budget we can support, because Scotland deserves better. I have pleasure in moving the amendment in my name.
I now call on Kezia Dugdale to be followed by Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Stronger for Scotland. That's what we were told the SNP would be. Vote for us, they said, and we will be stronger for Scotland. And those of us on the Labour benches always questioned who in Scotland the SNP would be stronger for. Well, now we know. This budget makes it abundantly clear. Stronger for the richest 1%. If you are already rich in Scotland, the SNP will protect you from paying your fair share. But if you are in an ordinary family whose children go to the local school, rely on the local GP, sometimes need to attend the local hospital, or whose elderly relatives need support from carers, then the SNP isn't stronger for you. The public services that you rely on will be downgraded, closed, or under pressure like never before as a consequence of this budget. Because in the same week that the SNP refused to ask the richest few earning more than £150,000 a year to pay just a little bit more tax, the government will team up with the Greens to impose £170 million worth more cuts to vital public services. And that makes it £1.5 billion worth of cuts since 2011. So much for stronger for Scotland. So let's take a look at that record. Are the plans to close the maternity unit at the Royal Alexandra Hospital in Paisley stronger for Scotland? are the 4,000 fewer teachers under the SNP an example of being stronger for Scotland? Is the utter shambles of ScotRail an example of being stronger for Scotland? With this budget, public services in Scotland face a budget double whammy from the SNP. Under the SNP Green Deal, local services like schools and care of the elderly face £170 million worth of cuts. These cuts will harm everybody, but they will hurt the poorest the most. But another feature of this year's budget process has been the concerns raised by employers across Scotland about the impact of business rate increases. And I know from my own local area that it is small firms, those at the very heart of their communities, that are most worried. Now, the SNP's shambolic U-turn on business rates for a specific group of firms, Mr Fitzpatrick, is welcome. But our public services are facing massive bills too. We know that the NHS chiefs warned the SNP last year that the health service could face a £30 million bill as a result of the re-evaluation. And we also know that our universities could be hit with multi-million pound increases. And at a time when maternity units are facing closure and other NHS services are being scaled back, it would be criminal for the SNP to do nothing to help. Now, the cuts that are being imposed on valued public services don't have to happen. Labour has been setting out throughout this process an alternative plan. It's a plan that says we don't have to accept the austerity imposed by the Tories, that we have the powers in this Parliament to chart a different course. Labour's plans would stop the cuts to public services we all value and allow us to invest in those public services instead. Because it's only with investment that we can chart a better future for Scotland's young people. More than happy to give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Doug Dale has mentioned a number of times cuts and also tried to make the case local. Can I point out, if we just take one example, the City of Edinburgh Council, maybe an area that Kezia would be interested in, the total increase for local services in the City of Edinburgh is over £30 million. That's a 3.9% increase.
Kezia Dugdale.
I don't accept those figures, and the Cabinet Secretary can hear from my colleague behind me that represents Edinburgh Southern that the figure is in fact a £27 million cut in Edinburgh and that there are £170 million worth of cuts across this country. And I have to say to the Cabinet Secretary, at stage one, I came in here and gave him very specific examples of fantastic projects in Edinburgh that are facing serious cuts or closures because of decisions that he's making. Now, he knows the troubles that local authorities are faced with across the country, and he still insists on cutting services by £170 million. It doesn't have to be this way. There is a different choice. Only with investment in education can we give our people the skills they need to compete for the jobs of the future. And it's not just about tackling poverty and inequality, as important as that is. There's an economic imperative to do this. In this rapidly changing world, where the kinds of jobs people do and how they do them continues to evolve beyond all recognition, we risk our people getting left behind. And we know that the people who almost always get left behind are not those from wealthy backgrounds. It's the ordinary working class families of Scotland who will lose out most from cuts to education. But it is all of Scotland that will be worse off as a consequence. Because locking so many people out of the jobs of the future means our economy won't and cannot grow at the rate that it needs to. If we are to compete with the likes of China, India and Brazil, then we need everybody in our country to have the skills necessary for those jobs of the future. To make the investment that is needed, we need those with the broadest shoulders to pay their fair share. Just as I believe that together we're stronger as a nation by remaining in the UK, together we're stronger as a nation when the wealthiest few pay just a little bit more so we can all benefit from improved public services. When members vote tonight, we will see who really is stronger for Scotland. A vote for a budget that imposes cuts to local services like schools and care for the elderly isn't evidence that you are stronger for Scotland. So we can either vote through this budget imposing £170 million worth of cuts to local services, or we can make true on the promises many of us in this chamber made to the people of Scotland. Labour said we would seek to stop the cuts and invest in the future of our economy and the future of our country. And that's what we'll do when we vote against this budget later on this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Patrick Harvey to be followed by Willie Rennie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Much like the discussions in the Chamber earlier this week on the rate resolution and on non-domestic rates, it's pretty much inevitable that this afternoon's debate is going to be entirely polarised, with some members offering glowing praise for a budget that has no flaws at all, and others offering utter condemnation, as though there is nothing to speak positively of at all. In reality, Presiding Officer, the record of the SNP in government is mixed, and the arguments in relation to this budget are mixed. The Green approach, ever since we entered Parliament in 1999, was to challenge governments, but to do so constructively with a view to make a difference. That's what we did when the Labour-Lib Dem administration was in office. That's what we've done with the SNP administration since then. That's what we've done whether the government's had a majority or not, and that's what we'll continue to do. Someone listening to budget debates this year for the first time might be forgiven for not knowing that all political parties in this chamber have voted for government budgets when they've been in opposition before. All parties have done this and will continue to do. January 2009, for example, the one time a Scottish budget fell, not because of Green unwillingness to be constructive, but because of brinkmanship by the administration. The Labour finance spokesperson during that debate called the SNP's approach shameful, said the budget failed key economic tests, offered consensus only on the SNP's terms, and then one week later, they voted for precisely the same budget without a single amendment. So there is a degree of, well, I don't want to be rude, Deputy Presiding Officer, but I don't think we can take fully seriously some of the outrage that's been expressed so far. All political parties have been at their best during budget debates when they've tried to make a difference rather than merely tried to express outrage.
Neil Findlay.
Mr. Harvey, your party had the SNP over a barrel in the budget negotiations. So which high environmental principles or tax justice principles did the Green Party advance when selling out local government to another 160 million of cuts?
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to Mr. Findlay for the opportunity to talk about local government, because that is precisely where the Green approach to this budget has made a difference. This year, we were most concerned, most angered by the cuts. Presiding Officer.
I'd like to hear what Mr. Harvey has to say, please.
We were most focused on the cuts to the unring-fenced core local government allocation. And what we secured is not just an additional allocation, not just the first formal budget amendment that we've seen in years in this Parliament, but 160 million of additional allocation to local government. I have never said that this budget is perfect, and I won't today. But this is the biggest budget concession that any administration since devolution has given to any opposition party. It will make a difference in every single local government area, including that Mr. Johnson represents.
Daniel Johnson.
Would he recognise that difference is still a £170 million cut to local government, whatever way he dresses it up?
Patrick Harvey.
Did that intervention by saying whatever way it's dressed up. It will always be possible to produce a different interpretation of the figures. And there are some creative thinkers on the other side as well. The Labour approach throughout has been to compare the draft budget with the outturn budget, with the amount that was spent during the current financial year. That's not a fair adjustment. What we've taken is the spice assessment of the figures. The spice analysis of the figures does not include I've taken a couple of interventions already. The Spice interpretation of the figures
does
not...
Can I ask particularly the Conservative benches to stop chattering away? I'd like to hear the debate.
The Spice interpretation of the figures is the closest thing we have to politically neutral and impartial judgment on this matter. And their assessment was that the core cut to the unround-fenced local government allocation was 166 million. They were not including the double counting of health and social care money or other allocations which should not be encountered within that overall pot. We argued that that should be reversed, and we've achieved a £160 million reduction in those cuts. The Spice assessment since the Stage 2 amendment was passed states that the budget line for local government, and I'm quoting here, is now essentially flat in real terms, a 0.1% reduction compared with the previous year's draft budget. And once you include the reforms to local council tax, not the 3%, which is up to local councils to decide, but the reforms to the multiplier, then it becomes a 0.7% increase. That is the difference that Greens have made in this budget, making a difference in every single local council area in Scotland. Additional funds which councils are free to allocate. And can I just once more remind members, with great respect, of the consequences. Daniel Johnson on Tuesday asked us to think about the consequences of the way that we vote. The consequences of voting down a budget at this stage would be to send local government, every single local council in Scotland, into a panic and the need to set emergency budgets, bringing back on the agenda the cuts that in recent weeks they've been able to cancel as a result of the work that we've achieved. As for the Conservative amendment in today's debate, I can never accept the principle that we should devolve, that we should finally persuade all parties to agree that tax powers should be devolved and then refuse to ever do anything progressive with them. That's the position that the Tories would advance. We should only ever cut tax for the rich, only ever do that, only ever become an ever meaner, more selfish, more self-interested economy in which wealth concentrates in the hands of ever fewer people. That's what the UK government is doing, and that's what they would have us do as well. We will never agree
to
that.
Can you begin to wind up, please,
Deputy Presiding Officer, Greens will vote in favour of this budget today, and I appeal to all parties in all future budget debates, don't just throw a tantrum, make a difference.
Thank you. I call Willie Rennie to be followed by Bruce Crawford. Mr Rennie, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Budgets are an opportunity to judge people not by their words, but by their actions. Hard numbers, hard cash reveals hard priorities. It's not easy, but it strips back all the talk and reveals the naked truth. We all remember the First Minister in the debates in the 2015 general election going around England saying that we should reject austerity and that Scotland would do it differently. But now we see from this budget what she really meant. And then we've had Patrick Harvey standing in those Scottish election debates, looking down his nose at everyone and pledging a greener and bolder Scotland. Now the Greens have voted for the budget at stage one. They've abstained at the rate resolution this week. So I'm looking for the full set. There is a possibility yet that he could yet vote against the budget. So the budget yet could fall. Patrick Harvey reminded us of 2009, when the budget did fall, when he changed his mind in the middle of the debate. So I would just urge the Finance Secretary to make absolutely sure that he has the Greens in his pocket, because it may well change after all.
Check them out.
But what we need to do now is, because the challenge is great, the challenge is enormous. We have Brexit coming down the track with a significant impact on our economy. We have our education system, as we all know, which is slipping down the international rankings, our once proud Scottish education system. And then we have 643,000 working days lost because of poor mental health. That's worth £54 million to our economy. And of course, there's the Sutton Trust, which has highlighted the real dramatic impact of the inequality gap in our education system. That is why there is an opportunity yet. The Greens could today vote against this budget, alongside perhaps others who are concerned about these issues. They could reject the budget. It is not too late yet, because we can do so much better than what has been agreed, not just now, was what has been agreed in this budget. If you look at the education system, we've lost 150,000 college places in the last few years, particularly hitting women and mature students. We need to invest in part-time courses. And then, of course, the issue about the pupil premium. Now, I'm glad to see the Scottish Government have moved after years of opposing the pupil premium, pioneered by the Liberal Democrats down south. I'm glad they have changed their mind and implemented a pupil equity fund. It's having a big impact in England. It's closed the attainment gap by 5 percentage points. But the amount of money that's been put into it is just simply not enough. If we can't even match what they're doing in England, how on earth are we going to get our education system back up the international rankings? And then, of course, we could have invested more in mental health. I want to take up the mental health budget to £1.2 billion. Now, all of the leaders stood on a platform in last May's elections, and we all agreed that mental health was a top priority. We all agreed. Every single leader said nobody could possibly disagree with this. But where is it in the budget? We don't even have it up to what was required to invest in Tier 1 and 2 counselling, to invest in emergency services, to invest in mental health professionals alongside the police, but also in primary care too. Where is the investment to make that happen? It isn't there. It's another missed opportunity. And all those wise words on the election platform last year come to absolutely nothing. So that is the disappointing thing about this budget. And this comes at a time when we have the opportunity to do something different. We've got new tax powers. The tax powers we've been wanting for years. So we could do something different from the rest of the United Kingdom. So we can chart our own path to mark a different way, to boost the economy, to improve our education system, to improve mental health services. And what do we do with it? We tinker with it. We tinker at the edges. We're not making a big difference. We've not got a transformational investment in education. We don't have a step change in mental health services. This is a timid, tinkering budget. We could do so much more for Scotland. I'm ambitious for this country. I want us to do so much more. Now, I don't want to ramp up tax all over the place. I want it dedicated towards a specific purpose of investing in people and the talents of people, in the mental health of people, so we can get them to work, so they can contribute to our economy, so they can create more wealth, so we can bring more taxes in. It's not all about the Conservative race to the bottom on tax. That's not the way to get a better Scotland, to get a more vibrant, energetic Scotland. The best way to do it is to invest in the talents of our people, because our people are the best way to proceed. So I would urge all of those who want a better Scotland, a more ambitious Scotland, to improve the economy, to make a real big difference to our future, to reject this budget, so we can go back to the start, so we can negotiate again a real proper budget that really meets the aspirations of this country. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Bruce Crawford, to be followed by Maurice Golden. Mr Crawford, please.
Officer, Presiding Officer, there have been many occasions since we first joined this Parliament together in 1999 when we've been able to say that today is an historic day. Well, I can safely say that today is yet another historic day. Today we set a budget for Scotland's health service, for Scotland's education services, for emergency services, for our local councils that contains around £11 billion of commitments supported by money raised from income tax. Presiding Officer, as the weeks and months turn into years, I'm confident we'll witness many more historic days as this Parliament grows from strength to strength. But let's reflect on the moment of today. What will future commentators make of the political players who took part in the setting of Scotland's budget for 2017-18? What will they make of the role of Finance Secretary, who had this historic privilege, although I'm not sure he always saw it that way, of setting the first budget to be supported by unprecedented levels of tax, raised in Scotland. A finance secretary who had to deal with the very real challenge of a revenue and capital Dell budget that's been reduced in real terms between 2010-11 and 2019-20 by 9.2%. He was a finance secretary who's also had the added difficulty of dealing with the volatility of Brexit and all the implications for public expenditure that that brings. You'll also have to deal with the immediate Brexit threat of rising inflation and as a direct consequence, a reduction in his real term spending power. And in the longer term, if that were not enough, the destruction of up to 80,000 jobs in Scotland if we are forced to leave the single market. Presiding officer, today we are also living in a world of much greater shared level of shared powers between Holyrood and Westminster than has existed at any time in our history, particularly as a result of the fiscal framework. That's why it is imperative that UK Treasury ministers appear before the Finance and Constitution Committee to give evidence. By refusing to give evidence and to attend, they simply either do not understand the nature of the devolved settlement they were responsible for creating, or they're treating this place with contempt. I really don't care which one of these is the reality, but what I want them to do is show some respect for this Parliament that belongs to the Scottish people. Presiding officer, it also makes you wonder who would take on the job of a finance secretary and then be landed with the additional complications of securing a budget agreement in a parliament of minorities. But securing agreement he has, an agreement that sees an additional £160 million allocated to local government. And while Parliament may find agreement at decision time today, you know, it will be of no credit to those who've chosen to be entirely oppositionalist in their approach, no matter the potential consequences for the public services and public finances. And the agreement that the Scottish Government secured with the Green Party should make the Labour Party in particular squirm with regret. But you know, I guess they won't, because they've become so wrapped up in their all-consuming opposition of the SNP and their own destruction, they've consigned themselves to be an utter irrelevance in Scottish political life today. Now, others might take some joy from that, but I think it's a very, very sad thing indeed. And I just wonder how history will judge the Labour Party's role on this significant day for Scotland. However, what is also clear is that history will judge the Conservative Party but financial fantasists. Throughout the budget process, Tory member after Tory member have brought forward spending proposals amounted to billions of pounds. Yeah. And when challenged on how they'll pay for them, we get nothing more than financial drivel. Firstly, we're told by Dean Lockhart that a fantasy sum of £500 million from maladministration would be used to fund Tory commitments amounting to billions. Well, I've got news for Mr. Lockhart. If £500 million was the cost of maladministration, which in itself is a load of nonsense, it's already been spent and can't be spent again. Then we have the fantasy of the position of Douglas Ross sitting also on the front bench there, who tells us that the alternative Tory approach is to expand the tax base by cutting the taxes for the wealthiest. Now, even if the Tory argument of cutting taxes to increase spending had any shred of credibility, just how would such a plan see any additional money being produced from an expanding tax base in the short time before the start of the financial year? It is absolute nonsense. And as for Murdo Fraser's financial fantasies, well, the least said, probably the better. Yeah. But you know, thank goodness we have a finance secretary who's been keeping his head while the opposition have been losing theirs. And that's why we should vote for the government's budget at decision time. And I ask this Parliament not to deny public services in Scotland an additional £900 million, not to deny the hospitality sector a cap on their rates, not to deny the local government an extra £160 million. And for goodness sake, just don't vote against a government at decision time just because it happens to be an SNP government. Vote for the budget.
I call Maurice Golden to be followed by Kate Forbes. Mr. Golden, please.
The Finance Secretary...
Now behave, I want to hear this as well. Thank you.
Thank you. The presiding, the Finance Secretary has a plethora of options available to vary tax, improve productivity and grow the Scottish economy. He also has more cash, £500 million more in real terms as against the current year. Patrick Harvey and the rest of the sellout six must have wondered why they didn't ask for more from the Finance Secretary as he managed to conjure up an extra £230 million since first presenting the budget only a few weeks ago. But if the SNP government's original tax proposals weren't dangerous enough, they have been made a whole lot worse now that the Greens are dictating the SNP's policy on taxation. So this left-wing SNP-Green coalition has introduced a tax system that will see individuals on pay scales similar to the First Minister pay a marginal tax rate of 42 pence in their last pound earned. A tax system that will see the CEO of RBS pay a marginal tax rate of 47% on the last pound earned, but hard-working Scots who earn between £43,000 and £45,000 a year will be paying an astonishing 52% marginal tax rate on the last pound they earn. Perhaps even more astonishing, though, is the SNP government has the audacity to claim that their taxation proposals are progressive. Yes, Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. I'm a little bit puzzled as to why in those two examples he's only interested in the top 10% of earners. Why is it that the Greens are the only party who've even tried to make the case for cutting tax for people on ordinary incomes around the average full-time salary, which is £26,000 a year? People would be paying less tax under our proposals. Why are the Conservatives only interested in those at the very top?
Maurice Golden.
The Conservatives are interested in everyone in Scotland, and we don't do that by hurting the middle classes and those middle-income earners. If you listen to our policies, the Scottish economy will grow, we'll improve productivity, and we'll have more money to spend on public services. Now, my economics professor always told me that GDP was God, and while I disagree with that analogy, I would welcome it if the Cabinet Secretary for Finance made more of an attempt to grow our economy. The Finance Secretary is fully aware that he has the powers to vary rates of tax by band and introduce new bands, and thus it is entirely possible for him to avoid forcing hard-pressed Scottish families to pay more than the 42% marginal rate of tax. If we accept the Finance Secretary is intent on making Scotland the highest taxed part of the UK, he could then have at least been more creative in his proposals to ensure that no hard-working Scot would be forced to pay this marginal tax rate. But if the First Minister wouldn't be able to stand up then and proclaim there has been no increase in Scotland's income tax rates, because for this SNP government is more interested in spin rather than standing up for the interests of Scottish families. Derek Mackay.
Cabinet Secretary.
Does Maurice Golden therefore think that PwC advisers are wrong when they said, although we don't expect any short-term impact on decision-making for people who may already be planning to relocate to Scotland or for Scottish business looking to attract staff, were they wrong when they contradicted the position from the Conservatives that there will be a mass exodus as a consequence of our tax proposition?
Maurice Golden.
It's a disincentive to work between 43,000 and 45,000, and I would expect that the Cabinet Secretary for Finance would have been better using a more innovative approach if they wanted a more progressive tax system. So, here we have it. A marginal tax rate of 52%. And the SNP government doing their best to impersonate 1970s Labour. And what will happen next year and the year after that? The Greens will most likely continue pursuing their hard left agenda and insist that the higher rate threshold stay at 43,000. And what will the SNP do? If the SNP don't increase the higher rate threshold over the next 4 years, there will be an £8,000 gap between the higher rate income tax thresholds in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK. This would result in Scottish taxpayers being burdened with a 52% marginal rate of tax on £8,000 of their income between the earnings of £43,000 and £51,000. Either the SNP government haven't considered the significant threat that this poses to Scotland's economy and the prosperity of all its citizens, or they don't consider it a problem. I'm not sure which is worse. When the SNP government erects an earning tax wall at 43%, do they expect this will have a positive or negative impact on earnings? Well, let me tell them what the impact will be. Less Scots earning over £43,000 a year, an ever-growing gap in earnings between Scotland and the rest of the UK, less money being spent in our local economy, and all of this is supposed to be designed to raise additional tax revenue. I urge the SNP government and this chamber to put Scotland first, and I urge this chamber to support the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. I call Kate Forbes, followed by Ian Gray. Ms Forbes, please.
I'd like to remind the chamber that I am the PLO to the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Constitution, which is a privilege, presiding officer, because this is the first budget. This is the first budget to raise revenue through limited tax powers for over 300 years. And that's what the people of Scotland wanted. The people of Scotland wanted the powers to raise revenue in Scotland in our way for our services, so that we didn't have to walk the Westminster way as the Tories would have us do, slashing taxes for the rich and slashing services harder. The Tories complain about divergence, but there is already divergence in that we deliver for all residents of Scotland, whatever your background, wherever you live, and the Tories only deliver for the top 10% of earners, and that is a far more dangerous divergence and downright unfair. And having waited that long for tax-raising powers, I'm so pleased that this budget will deliver for the Highlands. It's a budget for the crofter in Staffin, the engineer in Drumnadrochit, and the dinner lady in Dingwall. It is a budget for my constituents. Because people in the Highlands want reliable connectivity. And in this budget, there is over £100 million of investment in digital and mobile infrastructure to support our commitment to deliver 100% broadband across every Highland business and home. With pleasure.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. Does she not agree, however, with Councillor Margaret Davidson, the independent leader of Highland Council, who said this wasn't a good budget for Highland and told the Scottish Government to stop their efforts with smoke and mirrors because it's deluding people into thinking they have a better deal, and it sounds like Kate Forbes has fallen for it.
Kate Forbes.
Part I do agree with Douglas and Douglas's Ross comments is the smoke and mirrors, and we're sure seeing a lot of smoke and mirrors from the Tory benches. What I like to go on the basis of is the hard, cold, boring facts and figures, which show that public services in the Highlands are up £20 million versus last year. And I'd rather depend on the cold, hard figures than the smoke and mirrors that we've been seeing. So people in the Highlands want reliable connectivity. They also want more and affordable homes. And in this budget, we're investing heavily in the provision of affordable housing with over £470 million of direct capital investment to ensure that we're on track to deliver 50,000 affordable homes across Scotland, which will also support employment in construction and housing management. And it specifically maintains funding for rural and islands housing funds, which should be welcomed by every self-respecting rural constituency MSP. We also want improved roads and rail links, and this budget promises to progress design and development work on improvements to the A82, continue dualling the A9, and improve the stretch at the Berriedale Braes in my colleague Gail Ross's constituency, and invest in improving Highland rail links. We also want a well-resourced NHS Highland with more healthcare professionals, and this is a budget with £592 million for NHS Highland. And if the Tories had their way, they'd charge the sick for prescriptions, and instead we're protecting NHS funding.
Edward Mountain, please.
Sorry, I'm very happy to talk about the concerns of people in the Highlands regarding health provision, especially those on RASE who have lost their local nurse and have no provision at night, and especially those mums in Caithness who no longer have paediatricians in Caithness. How is that improving the services, and how is that going to help people in the local community get better health care?
Kate Forbes, could you wait your call again, please? I know you're anxious to respond. Kate Forbes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Point of order.
Perhaps your clerk had heard the word repeated twice by Gail Ross when she called Edward Mountain a liar. She said it twice.
No, can I just ask you to sit down? We heard nothing here, so we can't make any comment whatsoever. I'm sorry. Let's proceed. Please continue, Ms. Forbes.
Great. On the points that Edward Mountain makes, I agree with him on the point about RASE, and it's something that I'm actively engaged with NHS Highland, with the community. And I'd like to think that if you ask the community, and you may well have done so, they would say that I have been working closely with them to try and find a solution. But part of the problem, as we both will know, in NHS Highland, is the problem with recruiting professionals. And I mean, a BMA survey today shows that 4 in 10 European doctors are considering leaving the UK in the wake of the UK's vote to leave the EU. So that is hardly helping the real challenges we face in terms of recruitment. Presiding Officer, in the Highlands, we also want well-resourced education for our children and accessible further and higher education for our young people, and to attract other young people to study in the Highlands. And not only is this budget still committed to free education across Scotland, it's also providing additional money to directly reduce the impact of poverty on a child's educational attainment. And of the total 120 million, there's almost 4 million going straight to Highland schools. But more than anything else, we want local power. And the budget promises to empower island communities further so that island communities can build a more prosperous and fairer future for our communities. So that's our budget. And if you ever wanted confirmation that the Tories and the Labour Party only care about political posturing, watch how they vote tonight. Because to vote against this budget is to vote against connectivity, housing, roads and rail, a well-resourced NHS, and reducing the impact of poverty. That matters to my constituents, and it matters to me.
I now call Ian Gray, to be followed by Ash Denham. Mr. Gray, please.
Thank you. Excuse me. Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've had 19 budgets since devolution, by my count, 20 perhaps if we include two in 2009. And yet this one could and should have been different. It had the potential to be both transformed and transformational. Transformed because for the first time ever, a Scottish Government had significant powers over tax, the powers for us to decide for ourselves, that balance between what we ask our citizens to contribute and how much we will have to invest in our country's future. And transformational, firstly, because we could have used substantial new welfare powers to reshape the benefits system, create targeted new benefits to support the vulnerable, and thus transform their lives in the here and now. We could also have chosen to end 10 long years on the low road of squeezing education budgets and returned at last to the high road of investing in our young people's future and thereby transforming their prospects and the future of our country. Alas, the only thing this budget has actually transformed is itself through a series of U-turns, humiliating climb-downs and shameless flip-flops. It started with the debacle of the council tax when the finance secretary revealed that after 10 years and 3 elections of promising to abolish the council tax, he had, well, changed his mind. And the only thing he planned to do was to impose a swingeing increase across the board for higher bands.
Cabinet Secretary.
Specifically on council tax, would Ian Gray like to explain on behalf of the Labour Party why campaigning against the council tax year, if freeze for 9 years, Labour councils are now freezing the council tax?
Ian Gray.
Well, councils are taking the best decisions that they can locally, in my own local authority, the council have increased the council tax in order to protect services from the £4.5 million cuts imposed by the Finance Secretary. But the Finance Secretary's council tax plan was radical in one way, of course, because he planned initially to remove the proceeds of the council tax increase from local communities and use it to swell his own coffers. A redistribution of sorts, I suppose, in the way a smash and grab redistributes wealth too. In the first of his U-turns, the Finance Secretary had to abandon this plan by the time he brought his budget forward. This he did with great claims of extra money for schools, councils, the NHS, only for those claims to collapse under independent scrutiny. Scrutiny which discovered sums of money allocated in multiple budget lines in an effort to hide cuts of £327 million to councils. And then we had the Green Deal, which was, we were told, to stop those cuts that the week before the Finance Secretary had told us did not in fact exist. But of course that deal turned out too to be just a smaller cut, nor was it funded by progressive taxation, but in fact by creative accounting in the non-domestic rate pool. And the Finance Secretary wasn't done either, because this week his think-of-a-number budgeting led to the last great handbrake turn of the sorry budget process, when suddenly rates relief appeared for a handful of those businesses facing increases of 2 and 300%. And so, after all this sound and fury, the double counting, the fantasy forecasting, we end up pretty much where we started. No serious attempt to use the new tax powers, but simply accepting the UK Tory tax structure pretty much intact. No attempt at all to use the new welfare powers, with our most vulnerable citizens unnecessarily left at the mercy of Tory welfare reform for at least another 3 years. And as for education, the budget squeeze goes on. £120 million to close the attainment gap could be, should be, a serious welcome and needed effort to transform the lives of children from poorer backgrounds, if it did not have to be set against a £170 million cut to the councils who fund those schools. A commitment to expand childcare, if that didn't have to be set against, again, the cuts to councils who will be asked to deliver it, and indeed a nursery sector hammered by rates increases for which they received no help whatever this week. That's true of universities too, swinging increases in their rates at the same time as a 7.5% cut in their revenue funding. And as for colleges, great fanfare made of a tiny increase in their teaching budgets this year, covering up the fact that in real terms, college budgets have not yet caught up with 2006-07, when the SNP came to power 10 long years ago. And no support in the budget either for their students, struggling with a system which NUS describes as not fit for purpose. And isn't that the truth of this budget? New powers, new opportunity, but all this government can come up with is more of the same. And I say to Kate Forbes, yes, I believe the people did want this parliament to have tax powers, but I believe that they wanted us to use those tax powers in order to stop the cuts. That's what she and her colleagues promised a year ago. And yet, what they have delivered is the same cuts to education budgets, the same Tory austerity cuts simply passed on, the same squeezing of local services in particular, the same tired excuses for a timid government which does not have the vision or the guts to use the power of this parliament to do the things they only pay lip service to redistribute wealth, stop the cuts, and invest in our future.
Thank you. I call Ash Denham to be followed by Dean Lockhart. Ms. Denham, please.
Presiding Officer, we have spent some time now debating this budget, and the process has made many things clear.
mainly that while the Scottish Government has worked constructively to build a revenue and spending plan that is both fair and bold, the Tories have moved further to the right, turning their backs on the people of Scotland in favour of damaging rhetoric that is neither forthright nor productive in constructing a budget. In fact, last week, in a speech given in the backyard of her Westminster bosses, Ruth Davidson was daring enough to suggest that the First Minister faced a choice between a top priority of education or an independence referendum. She said the First Minister can't have it both ways. Now, I never want to know the realities of a Tory government in Holyrood, but it seems that Ruth Davidson cannot grasp that getting the best deal for the people of Scotland is not conducive to governing so narrowly. And that is why this budget does prioritise education by providing £1.6 billion to support higher and further education, while also making a record investment of £12.7 billion into health resource spending, while also expanding free childcare and early learning to 30 hours a week, while also handing head teachers of local schools an additional £120 million to use however they see fit, which will benefit 8 schools to the tune of just over £1 million in my constituency, Edinburgh Eastern, and while also lowering the business poundage rate, expanding the small business bonus scheme to exempt 100,000 properties from rates, and ensuring that 99% of Scots won't pay more in income tax. On top of that, announced this week, an additional tailored rates relief package to 9,500 businesses across Scotland. One need only look as far as Portobello in my constituency to see how this action will benefit many restaurants, pubs, hotels and cafes, which are the heart of our local communities. And I know that those businesses will be watching the Tories today, voting against crucial rates reliefs, voting against a package of support for small businesses. This is something the Tories themselves called for, but today they are caught out on their empty rhetoric once again. I think that Ruth Davidson would be better off lecturing her own party about trying to have it both ways, as the Scottish Tories have called for cutting taxes on the one hand while demanding millions of pounds of public service investments on the other. In reality, we know a Tory-led Holyrood would result in tax cuts for the wealthiest at the expense of our vital services that real Scots depend upon. And that is why voters sent the SNP to Holyrood, as the largest party with a mandate to pass a budget that is far-reaching and provides the kind of country that Scots demand, where students don't pay tuition fees for university, or the elderly for personal care, or parents for astronomical childcare costs. Working constructively with the Greens, the budget also now delivers an additional £160 million to local government to be spent at the discretion of individual authorities. And for Edinburgh, this equates to an extra £12 million to bolster important local services. All this with a reduction in the business poundage rate, with a large business supplement threshold that matches England's, and with the best support for small and medium-sized enterprises in the UK. This is what getting on with the day job looks like, prioritising the needs of Scottish people, because that is what being in this Scottish Parliament demands of us. But it seems as if the Scottish Tories would rather turn their eyes and ears away from Scotland and towards London, where they take their marching orders. That may explain why they have made no constructive engagement in this budget process at all. In fact, they had nothing to say about schools, they had nothing to say about hospitals, and they had nothing to say about infrastructure. All they could talk about was tax cuts, and more tax cuts. But this government hears the Scottish people, and it refuses to lead in the incoherent way that the Tories would have. For while the adage of Westminster may be austerity, in Scotland it is prosperity, it is fairness, it is a better deal than anywhere else in the UK. That is what this budget represents, and I urge those in the chamber today to join me in voting for it. Thank you.
Thank you. Dean Lockhart, to be followed by Gil Paterson. Mr. Lockhart, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In the Stage 1 budget debate, the Finance Secretary told this chamber that this budget will support jobs and lay the foundations for future growth. This budget is many things, but it is most definitely not a budget for economic growth and jobs. As Murdo Fraser said, the budget process is about choices, and the Finance Secretary has made decisions in two critical areas that will damage the economy and risk future government revenues. First of all, despite having an extra £500 million to spend, the Finance Secretary has slashed the enterprise budget by over £50 million. At a time, perhaps later, at a time, in his words, of significant challenge in our economy. At least we can agree on that last point. This is indeed a time of significant challenge to our economy. And that's precisely why slashing the enterprise budget, which supports new and expanding businesses across all sectors in Scotland, is the wrong thing to do. I will later. Just to be clear, Mr. Mackay earlier said he's given Scottish Enterprise an extra £35 million. No, he hasn't. The budget originally cut the enterprise budget by £85 million. Now the cut is £50 million. Only in the fantasy world of SNP economic policy would this be seen as extra funding. Mr. Mackay.
Cabinet Secretary.
To ask Dean Lockhart the question, there's just a specific example of another spending request from the Conservatives. Where else from the budget do you propose that we take that from to fund another item of expenditure within our proposals?
Dean Lockhart.
I could be flippant and mention Mr. Mackay's sofa, but let me make it clear to him. Had growth in Scotland's economy under the SNP matched growth in the UK since 2007, GDP in Scotland would have been £3.1 billion higher over the last 10 years. This is an extra £1,200 per person or per household in Scotland. That's where the extra money is coming from. Grow the economy, not increase tax. In justifying the decision to cut the enterprise budget, the Finance Secretary has pointed to other measures being taken to boost the economy, including the growth scheme, which he says will provide up to £500 million of investment guarantees and loans. The only problem is this budget fails to provide additional funding for this growth scheme. So I ask the government, where is the additional funding coming from to finance the £500 million growth scheme? Show me the money, Mr. Mackay.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I ask Dean Lockhart, do you understand what contingent liabilities are? Because this has been explained to you before. Would you like a further briefing on that? That explains how the £500 million Scottish Growth Scheme is funded.
Dean Lockhart.
Indeed, Mr. Mackay, under International Accounting Standards number 37, I know what contingent liabilities are. They are off balance sheet, but you have repeatedly, as has your colleague Mr. Brown, said that there will be fresh loans under this scheme, fresh funding. That money is not available in the budget. When I asked Keith Brown this earlier today, he was unable to answer the question, where's this money coming from? He did indicate that it might come from the existing enterprise budget, but as we've heard, this budget is being cut by over £50 million. It's now becoming clear this £500 million growth scheme is another example of SNP repackaging existing money and presenting it as new. All headlines, but no substance and no extra cash. Just like the mythical Scottish Business Development Bank, first announced by the SNP in 2013 to expand high-growth business in Scotland, and after 4 years later, still nowhere to be seen. Not right now. With such abysmal economic policymaking, it is no wonder that the economy in Scotland under the SNP is performing so badly. The second area in which the Finance Secretary had a choice was whether or not to increase tax on jobs and take-home pay. We now know that he didn't need to increase the tax burden on hard-working families in Scotland, but the Finance Secretary decided to abandon the centre ground and lurch to the left and join the Greens to increase tax on the hard-working people of Scotland. I would urge the Finance Secretary in the future to listen to the advice of business leaders on the economy and not the Greens. As the Chamber of Commerce has said, growing our economy rather than increasing tax will boost tax revenues and public spending. We agree. Not right now. Let me just refer to what Bruce Crawford and Ash Denham asked. How would we finance the extra spending? And I've already mentioned this to Mr. Mackay. There is, if Scottish the economy had grown at the same level as the UK under the SNP government, you would have an extra £3.1 billion. Economic growth is the answer, not increasing tax. And that's why we'll not support this budget. Yes, go ahead.
Ash Denham. Well, go ahead. It's not very polite, Mr Lockhart. Ms Denham.
The Conservatives are very fond of claiming that Scotland has received more money from the old benevolent Westminster government. But yet, the facts are that we've had a drastic 9% real terms reduction over this Parliament and the last Parliament. Perhaps if Westminster had continued to support Scotland financially, the economy would have grown further.
Mr Lockhart.
Well, let me just refer to the research by Spice, where they show the real term numbers have increased from 2010 to this current budget. I have the numbers here, and I'm happy to compare notes with the member later. Presiding officer, the debate...
Excuse me a minute, there's no point in debating across the chamber with each other. If you want to make a point, either of you, Mr Ross, the Cabinet Secretary, intervene.
Thank you. Presiding officer, the debates on the budget have quite rightly focused on how we can increase funding for vital public services. However, no discussion on the funding of public services can be complete without recognising the fundamental importance of funding through the Barnett consequentials. For example, of the £380 million increase in NHS spending in Scotland last year, over £350 million was funding from Barnett consequentials. Earlier this week, one of the country's top economic forecasters, Douglas McWilliams from the Centre for Economics and Business Research, provided a timely reminder of the importance of the Barnett formula and the impact that independence would have on public services in Scotland. He said, in the event of independence, and I quote, there would need to be cuts in public spending of about 15% of GDP. 15. That's roughly 15%. On the scale of what has happened in Greece. Let me conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer. In dragging this high-tax budget through Parliament, the pro-independent coalition of the SNP and Greens have argued that increasing tax is progressive. Let me make it clear, there is absolutely nothing progressive about the massive cuts to public spending and to vital public services that would be the direct consequence of their obsession with independence. I support the amendment in Murdo Fraser's name.
Thank you, Mr Lockhart. Now, before I call you, Mr Paterson, can I remind members there's a practice in the chamber that after you've made your speech, you wait the next two speeches before you leave the chamber. Two members have done that. I just tell you to bear in mind it's a courtesy to other speakers, and those people will find out who they are later today. Thank you, Mr Paterson.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. This budget delivers on the promises this government was elected on. This is a budget created in Scotland for Scotland, not dictated to us by Westminster. But of course, Scotland's finances are still being strangled by the UK Tory government. However, we will not bend to their plan of total austerity. We will not sell off Scotland's public services. We will not bow to privatisation. However, we will ensure economic growth, social justice and the protection of our services. We all found out yesterday from the independent research that Scotland is not the highest taxed part of the United Kingdom. This destroys the complaints from the Tories that this is the case. Spice found out that any tax rises are mitigated by the lower council tax in Scotland. And it is important to mention all council tax will be spent locally. Nationally, Labour say increased tax. That's their mantra. We've had it throughout this process. But last night, when the prospect of increasing tax by Labour in Western Bartonshire Council, they voted to freeze the council tax after years of complaining bitterly locally about this. Of course,
Jackie Bailey.
Isn't it the case that the SNP councillors voted to increase the council tax by 3%, ignoring the impact it would have on some of the poorest in our community?
Yeah,
Gil Paterson.
That might well be the case, Miss Bailey. But the point is locally that your councillors and you particularly have been berating the fact that the council tax was frozen and you continued that freeze. That's what we're talking about here. We have the business bonus, but we also have the social bonus. Free further education, free prescriptions and free bus passes, among other benefits exclusive to Scotland. But I'm sad to see that the Tories demand a tax reduction for the highest paid. Should we not maintain the principle, the more you earn, the more you contribute? Thankfully, there are many higher earners who will gladly contribute their fair share, and I thank them very much for it. The Scottish Budget protects Scottish services. We have invested in education. I welcome new funds set to be given to schools in my own constituency, where most of the schools will benefit from it. But more importantly, more funding will go through this mechanism to underprivileged pupils. This will help improve the life chances of many, many young people, and it will help reduce the attainment gap, as the government has vowed to do. The funding increase for universities and colleges is also excellent news, and as I said, free education will continue. If the Tories had their way, everyone would have to pay the huge fees seen down south. But I believe that every person, no matter what their background is, should get the chance of a great education if they choose to do so. The SNP is delivering on its promises. Presiding officer, poverty scars Scotland and the problem is historic. But we are tackling it. Many of my constituents will benefit from the Scottish Government continuing to mitigate the impact of the hated bedroom tax. Many in my constituency will also benefit from the Scottish Welfare Fund, a fund that will clear up the mess left by the UK government's punitive welfare programme, and the wheels are in motion for a new Scottish social security system. With the powers we have, we will run welfare with dignity and respect. Presiding officer, economic growth is the key to Scotland's prosperity. With the few tools that we have, we are still driving economic growth. £4 billion invested into our infrastructure. Most of us will have seen the amazing developments taking place. For example, the motorway projects on the M8 and M74 and the stunning Queen's Ferry crossing. And there are many more progressing across the country. These are all the drivers of economic growth and will improve the lives of millions. This SNP government is building our economy. In Clydebank, in my constituency, we boast of one of the finest heart surgery hospitals in the world. The Golden Jubilee National Hospital is to receive multi-million pound expansion and 700 new jobs. Not transfer jobs, these are new jobs, real jobs, brand new jobs into the local economy. And the Health and Social Care Partnership helps some of the most vulnerable constituents of mine. Presiding officer, this budget is about economic growth, investment in our public services and social justice, protecting our most vulnerable from class war waged by the Tories. This budget is about making Scotland's economy prosper. This budget is about investing in and protecting public services. I call on all MSPs to back this budget tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Call Tom Arthur to be followed by Anna Salwar, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am delighted, particularly as a newly elected member.
Your microphone, please, Mr. Arthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm delighted to have the opportunity, particularly as a newly elected member, to participate in this afternoon's historic Stage 3 budget debate. It is my view that this is a fair and proportionate budget that balances the imperatives of public spending with the exigencies of supporting economic growth at a time of Brexit-driven uncertainty. The proposals outlined in this budget will both increase resources for local services in totality and increase health spending above inflation. In my constituency of Renfrewshire South, this translates to almost £5 million in additional support for integration authorities and over £1.5 million direct to schools through the Pupil Equity Fund. While St David's Primary in Johnston already benefits from attainment challenging funding, the Pupil Equity Fund provided by this budget means that, to give just a few of the many examples, in Barrhead, both St Mark's and Calabar Primaries will each receive an excess of £120,000. Johnston High will receive over £110,000. And Woodlands Primary in Linwood will benefit from almost £150,000. This is real money that will make a real difference to the lives of children and young people in my constituency. And those who vote against this budget tonight are voting against that money going to these schools.
Neil Findlay.
Does that mean that every time the SNP have voted against a budget in here or in any council chamber, that they're voting against every single thing in that budget? I mean, let's get beyond this childish stuff.
Tom Arthur.
The context in that remark is I hear from the Labour Party calls for increased investment in education. We provide increased investment in education. But what do? They vote against it. So, it does answer the question. Now, Presiding Officer, a frustration shared by many of my constituents, particularly in Howard and Lochwinnoch, has been the historic lack of access to superfast broadband. On doorstep after doorstep during the election campaign, this government's commitment to provide superfast broadband access to 95% of homes by the end of this year and access to 100% of premises in Scotland by 2021 was warmly received. I know that many of my constituents will join me in welcoming the support provided by this budget to deliver the final phase of the Digital Scotland Superfast Broadband Programme and the commencement of the first phase of the Reaching 100% Programme. Presiding Officer, whether it be in health, education or digital infrastructure, this is a budget that will deliver for my constituents in Renfrewshire South and deliver for the people of Scotland. This cannot be said, however, about the Tory and Labour proposals. Labour's tax proposition is, in my opinion, unfair, ill-advised and incoherent. It is unfair to ask people on less than £12,000 a year to foot the bill for Tory austerity. It is ill-advised to advocate an increase. It is ill-advised to advocate an increase in the additional rate without regard to the potential behavioural impact and consequent reduction in tax revenue. Well, I'd rather deal in a pragmatic reality than in Labour's clown car economics. And it is incoherent to push for tax increases on the lowest earners in society while simultaneously implementing council tax freezes across the country on the grounds that so many people are having to tighten their own budgets and, in the worst cases, are struggling to provide the basics for their families. Not my words, Presiding Officer, but those of outgoing Labour Renfrewshire Council Leader Mark McMillan. And it is incoherence that has characterised Labour's whole approach to this budget process at every level, which has resulted in Labour's politics being viewed by the overwhelming majority of people in Scotland as outdated, misplaced and irrelevant to the needs. Something confirmed yet again by the grotesque chaos of Labour's walkout at Clackmannanshire Council this morning. While Labour would hammer the least affluent in society with tax rises, the Tories want to cut tax for the most affluent at the expense of our public services. Presiding Officer, this budget process has been very revealing about the values and character of the Conservatives, and that it confirms what we've always known, that despite the talk over the past 10 years of rebranding and disbanding and a refreshed membership, it is still the same old Tories. Let me give you one example. East Renfrewshire stand to benefit by over an additional £3 million announced earlier in the budget process. Budget was set last week. Now, what did the Conservatives decide to do? What was their suggestion for how that revenue should be spent? Education? Additional investment in health? No. Their proposition was a 6% council tax cut in the most affluent part, one of the most affluent parts of Scotland. And I think it says all that we need to know about the values of the Conservative Party. For all our talk of there being the highest taxed part of the UK, the people who stand to benefit from the Conservative proposition are those highest earners, not the people who are most vulnerable and people most in most need of support. This budget is a budget that delivers for all of Scotland, and I'm proud to support it.
I have Anna Sarwar, followed by Joan McAlpin.
Presiding Officer, almost on a daily basis we hear SNP members saying this is a historic day, it's a historic moment, it's a historic progress towards whatever it is they dream of every single night. But in actual fact, what this is a historic waste of time and a historic wasted opportunity. Because this government spends every waking moment saying, we want more power, more power, more power. But when they get the power, they don't want to do anything about it. Welfare power is all we need to wait and see. Tax power is all we don't want to use the tax powers. And I listened very carefully to Tom Arthur's argument about the 50p tax ban. I've heard that argument before. It's a Tory argument to say people will flee if you introduce a 50p tax ban. But in actual fact, Nicola Sturgeon used to support a 50p tax ban. It was when she was playing the game of the 2015 general election, when she said that she supports a 50p tax ban. But now when they have the power and they have the opportunity, they don't want to use it. Because the truth is, when it comes to tax policy, Derek Mackay, Nicola Sturgeon and the SNP benches are Tory unionist on tax policy rather than actually wanting to use the tax policy. And I've got to say, this budget was meant to be about protecting communities. I'm sorry. All this budget does is protect the Yes Alliance. Happy to take an intervention.
Joan McAlpin.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. Can you explain why the last Labour government didn't put the tax rate up for the highest earners until 2010?
Well,
Anna Sarwar.
I'm sorry that Joan McAlpin perhaps wasn't paying attention to what happened under the last Labour government, but we did introduce the 50p tax ban. But this budget is all about protecting the Yes Alliance, not protecting the poorest and most vulnerable communities. And I listened to Patrick Harvey's contribution. Patrick Harvey's a man that I respect. I almost think that he is a man that speaks on principle. But the reality is that this is a Glasgow MSP who fails to recognise a cut to Glasgow's budget. A £53 million cut to Glasgow's budget, something his own councillors voted upon last week. I'm happy to take him.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to Mr Sarwar for giving way. This is a Glasgow MSP who has won an additional £17 million. And I agree. I want more, and I wish we had more, and I wish we were investing more. But what exactly has Anna Sarwar's party's approach achieved in terms of real, meaningful difference, pushing the SNP to do something they didn't want to do? Nothing.
Anna Sarwar, I'll give you the extra time, Mr. Sarwar.
I am so glad that Mr. Harvey made that intervention, because what the equivalent of the Green and SNP deal is, is it someone coming to Patrick Harvey, someone coming to Derek Mackay, someone coming to Nicola Sturgeon and saying, you're going to get a £15,000 pay cut. They then come back and say, actually, you're getting a £10,000 pay cut, but you should be happy because you're getting £5,000 extra. That's the equivalent of the argument you're making in this debate. There is no extra money. There are still cuts to communities across the country. And look at the SNP benches. Not a single utterance of opposition to a cut to budgets in your own communities. No backbone, no ability to stand up to your own government, no ability to stand up to your masters, no opinion of your own, no ideology, no thought except independence. Because I take pleasure standing shoulder to shoulder with every single SNP MSP in Glasgow against the proposals to close job centres in the city. But why aren't they standing shoulder to shoulder with us now when the budget in the city is getting cut? Why aren't they standing shoulder to shoulder with us now when there's actually NHS cuts happening across the country? Because the reality is, it's easy to be tough when you're talking about what's happening by them in Westminster, but not showing any backbone when your own government makes bad decisions right here in Scotland. And I'll tell you where else I was this week. I was at the health board this week to protest against claims. I'm glad Mr. Mackay is laughing, because I'm going to talk about the REH, which is part of the area that he represents. I was at the health board this week, standing shoulder to shoulder with Neil Bibby in opposition to the closure of the kids' ward at the REH. Where was George Adam? Where was Derek Mackay? Where were these MSPs? They were outside McDonald's campaigning against a closure there. Or perhaps they were buying Nicola Sturgeon a Happy Meal. Because the reality is that when it comes to standing up for their communities, they are nowhere to be seen. And I've seen the social care promise that was made in this budget. Apparently we're getting £107 million more for social care. The reality is, at the same time, they're writing to councils to say you can withdraw up to £80 million for IJBs. And what's the consequence? What's the consequence? Delayed discharge being at over 500,000 bed days lost when the Cabinet Secretary promised to eradicate it by the start of 2016. 500,000 bed days. That's the equivalent of every single bed, every single day and more at the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital being occupied by patients who are fit to leave but are trapped in hospital. A shame on every single SNP member across this chamber, because after 10 years of this government, we have seen inequality rise, health inequality rise, the gap not narrow but widen, the attainment gap widen, not narrow, the wealth gap widen, not narrow. But what is the SNP's version of redistribution of wealth? What is the SNP's version of redistribution of wealth? It is to cut air passenger duty for frequent flyers while reviewing the bus pass for pensioners across the country. That's the real truth of this SNP government. And so in closing, presiding officer, I will be voting against the budget because I believe in prosperity, because I believe in fairness, because I stand up against poverty, because I reject austerity. What will the SNP members do? I know what they'll do. They'll do what they're told.
We have Joan McAlpin, please, followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If we've learned anything today, Presiding Officer, is that the Tories are economically innumerate, that their sums don't add up. All through this budget process, we've heard the Tories made uncosted spending demands simultaneous with demands for tax cuts. They make two completely contradictory assertions at exactly the same time and apparently without any embarrassment or shame. George Orwell called it doublethink. I call it a double cross, Presiding Officer. The Tories are not fooling anyone except themselves. You can't cut taxes and spend more at the same time. And no amount of silly extended metaphors about overstuffed sofas can divert us from that dodgy arithmetic. The Tories lined up today to demand extra spending. Yes, I will, Mr Fraser, yes.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm grateful for Joan McAlpin for giving way on that point. Where was Joan McAlpin in election after election when the SNP stood on a manifesto to cut corporation tax by 3% in order to grow the tax take and grow the economy? Was that completely wrong?
Joan McAlpin.
Well, you don't expect immediate returns for a tax cut, which is exactly why your sums don't add up, because you're not actually coming up with the money immediately to make all these spending demands. And I'll just go through some of the spending demands that we've heard today. Dean Lockhart wants more for Scottish Enterprise. Edward Mountain demanded more to fill health vacancies, despite the £12.7 billion being allocated to the NHS this year. Presiding officer, it's not just that their sums don't add up. The basic Tory assertion that Scots will pay more tax is simply not true. And the fact is 99% of people in Scotland will pay no more tax, given their current level of income, than in 2016-17. Income tax is not going up in Scotland. Instead, the Tories are giving the richest 10% in the rest of the UK a big tax cut. The Tories propose to raise the level at which people start paying the higher rate of income tax from £43,000 to £50,000 by 2020. It's a massive tax cut which the Conservatives themselves forecast will cost the UK £1.6 billion. And I'm very glad that that cost won't fall in Scotland because of the fair and sensible policies pursued here. Scotland will freeze income tax rates for the entire life of this Parliament, and freezing income tax is not the same as raising income tax, yet the Tories continue to assert that it is. The price of this will be paid by ordinary basic rate taxpayers through increased charges and fewer services. The real high tax party is in fact the Tory party. In England, it's Tory taxes that are higher for poor people who have to pay the Tories' bedroom tax, which the Scottish Government has effectively wiped out here in Scotland at a cost of £47 million. Yes, I will.
Anna Sarwar.
Please clarify, she said that they'll be freezing income tax rates for the duration of the Parliament. Does that mean the top rate of tax will not rise throughout the duration of this Parliament? Is that what she's saying today?
Joan McAlpin.
Well, as you have already heard, said, that is something that's being considered at the moment. One example is of the new Scottish Welfare Fund introduced by the SNP for the most vulnerable in our society, which will benefit 217,000 households affected by emergencies, financial crisis and the effects of the UK government's cruel welfare cuts, which incidentally Sheffield Hallam University calculate will take £1 billion out of the Scottish economy by 2020. In England, you have the Tory tax on education, of course, because in England, students have to pay £9,000 in tuition fees. Tuition fees were, of course, introduced by a Labour government that Anna Sarwar was part of, as I recall. So 120,000 Scottish undergraduates don't have to pay. In England, Tory taxes are higher for the sick. They must pay 50 for every single item of medicine and won't betide you if you have multiple conditions. And in England, 100,000 people suffering from long-term conditions are hit by this Tory tax. And these Tory taxes also apply to older people. Around 77,000 people benefit from free personal care in Scotland, which is not available in England, saving self-funders in residential care almost £9,000 a year. So effectively, that's another tax that these older people in Scotland do not have to pay. So the SNP doesn't need to take any lessons from the Tories on taxes. It's Tory tax and benefit changes that are hurting the most vulnerable more than the rich. And since 2010, the only income tax rate that the Conservatives have cut is the additional rate from 50 pence to 45 pence, which gives an insight into their priorities. The Tories are the party of hidden taxes. They plan tax cuts for the rich and stealth taxes for those on low and middle incomes, for the sick, the poor, struggling families, for students, for the disabled and the old. It's now 15 years since Theresa May stood up at the Tory party conference and told her colleagues that they were the nasty party. We've had many changes in politics since then. Mrs May has gone from party chairman to prime minister, but I'm afraid that nasty party tag still sticks. Thank you.
Have Oliver Mundell to be followed by George Adam.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I have to be honest, as a still relatively new member of this Parliament, that I have been a bit bemused at the circus these last few weeks, and I've been struggling to keep up with Derek Mackay's new budget revisions. But more difficult for me, I've also been trying to work out which of my two conclusions is actually worse. A finance secretary who didn't notice the missing millions from his own budget, or a finance secretary who willfully decided to hide them whilst hiking up taxes and cutting funding for local government and other public services. I suppose at least all of this clears up some of the confusion about why those on the SNP benches thought that they had less money to spend if they weren't actually planning to spend it. Nonetheless, I'd still come into today's debate hopeful. Hopeful that even in this, the 11th hour, Derek Mackay might change not just his mind, but his mindset. Some of my colleagues might have thought that I was being a bit naive, but given all the unexpected windfalls and U-turns since the draft budget was published, I was beginning to think that nothing was impossible. In fairness, I thought that given this Cabinet Secretary likes finding new money so much, and given the newfound propensity of his government to bound into action in response to Tory concerns, I thought that Derek Mackay might actually be willing to go the full hog and embrace the principles of economic growth and competitive taxation in order to grow the overall tax take. Instead, he's anchoring himself steadfast to the mistaken belief that it is the level of taxation, not the level of economic success, that will protect our public services and increase living standards. In doing so, he's single-handedly failing in his duty to properly redistribute the wealth of our nation and setting out on an economic path that will deny a generation of Scots jobs, economic opportunities, and the well-funded public services they deserve. Worst of all, in doing so, the Finance Secretary is masquerading as some kind of modern-day Robin Hood. The only problem is that Derek Mackay is not taking from the rich to help the poorest. No, he's more like the Sheriff of Nottingham, putting forward a budget that's robbing all of us in order to pay for 10 years of SNP failure. And no, thank you. And instead, I fear that this is more a case of the Emperor's new clothes, where the newfound powers seem to have gone to the Finance Secretary's head, and he's been convinced to parade the naked truth about the SNP's economic policy in front of the people of Scotland. Because the truth is, if they have an economic plan, it must be invisible. Undeterred, the Finance Secretary soldiers on, believing so strongly in his own spin that he doesn't even seem to have noticed the outcry. Yes?
Derek Mackay.
Could just interrupt the member's insults for a moment, and could the member then turn to his proposition to tell us what area of funding would the Conservatives cut to fund their tax cut for the richest in society?
Oliver Mundell.
We are looking, as we've said repeatedly, and I don't know how many times you have to tell this Finance Secretary, that if you reduce the rate of taxation and maintain competitive taxes, then you can grow the economy. And I'll continue, there's no escaping it. His government has been found out. The years of economic indifference are coming home to roost. Blaming the UK government for years of their own inertia no longer washes. We now know once and for all that this is a socially heartless and economically soulless government who have chosen, and believe me, the austerity of economic self-destruction is a choice, to push thousands of businesses to the wall, to demand that those on middle incomes pay more council tax, and to send out an unequivocal message to the financially mobile and those who want to invest in Scotland that we are no longer open for business. And all of this hurts our economy and means less money to redistribute in future years. That hurts our schools, our NHS and the most vulnerable in our society, and it's just not good enough. No doubt I'll be told that I'm talking Scotland down or making insults. Well, at least, unlike this Scottish Government, I'm not doing Scotland down. Indeed, it's about time that the SNP realised that calling out their incompetence is actually about talking Scotland up. Because unlike the fanatical hard-left separatists, I don't believe that Scotland's too wee or too small to grow. Nor do I think that we're shackled by our United Kingdom. And I certainly do believe that we can make a success of Brexit. But we're not going to achieve any of that by reducing our competitiveness and making ourselves the highest tax part of our United Kingdom. Perhaps, I'm in my last minute, perhaps it's because I represent a constituency on the border where people have to make a choice about where to live, work and do business. And that choice for them is very immediate. But I believe more strongly than ever that we're starting to pay a very high price for SNP rule. That's why I won't be voting with the Scottish Government this evening, and I wholeheartedly back the amendment in the name of Murdo Fraser. Thank you.
The last of the open speeches is George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would first like to say how pleased I am to speak in this debate, as it's not only the budget debate, but it's also the first time a good friend and colleague, Derek Mackay, has presented this to us as the Cabinet Secretary for Finance. But the first time in history as well that we, the MSP of Scotland, have the power to make new decisions ourselves for our country. This budget heralds a material change in the financial responsibilities for the Scottish Parliament, including the first opportunity to set income tax and thresholds. This is an important step towards Scotland's future and growth as a country. In regards to the budget itself, this budget is fair, focused and forward-thinking towards promoting Scottish interests and protecting Scottish people. This budget rejects the austerity so loved by the Tory party in Westminster and said secures an additional £900 million to spend on our public services. We believe that money is better spent on the things that matter to most people, the things that have the ability to make or break everyday taxpayer and everyday families. Health, education, jobs, local services, these are the things that make a successful and fair society. By making our priority people and public services, Scottish taxpayers get more for their money and a much better deal than anywhere else in the UK. I'll take the member's comedy turn now.
Anna Sarwar.
The member talks about local services. He talks about the NHS. Today on Twitter, he was saying 140 characters, not enough to say what his position on the REH is. So when he gets back on his feet, can he tell us, will he demand that his health secretary calls in the proposal and rejects the plan to close the REH kids ward?
George Adam. We've sat here today on three or four occasions from Kezia Dugdale and from the member present as well, attacking members of my community who have low-wage jobs and low incomes because I stood up for them to try and make sure that they had future prosperity for the families in Paisley. So don't come to me, Mr Sarwar, with your playing politicking with hospitals. At this point, the Tories will no doubt fixate upon what they perceive to be a disregard of Scotland's highest income taxpayers. Yet at that moment, they're only being asked to pay a little bit more each year compared to the rest of the UK. This is greatly offset by the savings these earners will benefit for in respect of free prescriptions, free higher education and other vital public services in Scotland. The difference with England amounts to around £760 a week. Compare that to £840 it costs an average person south of the border for prescriptions. That's £8.40 for prescriptions, Presiding Officer. I've watched the passage of the budget bill through the chamber and at committee level, and I've seen the debate between Murdo, Fraser and Derek Mackay. It's been an example of two different approaches and styles of and political beliefs. There is, however, one major big difference. I've known Derek Mackay all his political life, and the big difference is that Derek has won every election he stood in, as opposed to Mr Fraser, who has lost every campaign. The public, it seems, have real insight in their choice of elected members. In contrast, the Labour Party's suggestion to raise tax would undoubtedly affect our low-income taxpayers the most, and this is something that this government will certainly not get on board with. Instead, this government will freeze income tax rates, and despite Westminster cutting the Scottish budget, they will not pass an austerity to the household budgets of the lowest incomes in our society. Indeed, this government continues to protect some of the poorest within our society from the negative impacts of the UK government welfare cuts, while attempting to tackle poverty, protect those with disabilities and continue to develop a Scottish social society, a social security system based on dignity and respect. Locally, this budget recognises the importance of community resources. Local government is an integral and essential part of overall good governance of Scotland and continues to be a key partner in the Scottish Government's transformation programme for public sector reform. In acknowledgement of this, Scotland's local authorities are to bear benefit from an additional £160 million investment to spend on local priorities on top of the £240 million already pledged for local services. Every council area will benefit from the additional funding through the Attainment Scotland Fund, which will help to significantly close the attainment gap and further promote a fair and equal society for every Scottish citizen. In addition, all of the extra council tax income estimated at £111 million in 2017-18, raised by the reforms of our council tax from Band Z and H, will be retained in full in each local authority area. Each authority can then decide how to spend this money themselves, based on their own local priorities and needs. All council tax raised locally will be spent locally. These council tax reforms will provide additional support to families of low incomes across all council tax bands by extending the relief available to households with children, which could benefit 77,000 families and an estimated 140,000 children. From healthcare, this budget proposes a record investment in NHS and sends the total health resource spent to a soaring £12.7 billion. During times of difficulty and uncertainty, it is crucial for the NHS to remain a priority service for the Scottish people. Presiding Officer, in challenging times, this budget delivers for people of Scotland, and this Cabinet Secretary is showing the way forward for the prosperous, fair Scotland we all want to live in.
We now come to the closing speeches, and despite all the noise this afternoon, I actually have some time in hand, so I can give some time for interventions if you wish to carry on the spirit of debate as it has been so far, but from a standing position instead of sitting on your seat. So can I please call Jackie Bailey? Around 6 minutes, please, Ms Bailey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Labour's approach from the start of the budget process has been to use the new powers of this Parliament to stop the cuts in full, not in part, so we can invest in public services and invest in our people to grow the economy. That stands in stark contrast to the SNP, who are content to simply operate as a conveyor belt for Tory cuts. We now have the power to do things differently, but it takes political will, something which appears to be strangely absent from the SNP. Every time we debate this subject, the SNP simply blame the Tories for the cuts. And, you know, I confess to having a modicum of sympathy for that approach. But when the SNP have the power to change that and refuse to do so, I part company with them completely. I also consistently remind this chamber about the First Minister's pronouncements on the issue of Tory austerity. You know, she used to believe in being anti-austerity. That was at a time when she had fewer powers than she does now. Now she can actually deliver it. Isn't it just such a shame that she no longer wants to do so? The SNP always demand more powers. They are, after all, the party of independence. But what a shame it is that they don't want to use the powers they have to protect our public services and our economy. Now, we've heard a list of good things from SNP backbenchers today. It's not about denying those things. We believe this parliament can and should do more. And you see, they can't really get away from the cuts they are making in a second, because no amount of double counting on the part of SNP ministers can hide this. 170 million this year slashed from local services, a total of 1.5 billion since 2011, much of it on the Deputy First Minister's watch. What does he have to say about that?
John Swinney.
What I have to ask is, she says there's no denying the good things in the budget. Why on earth is the Labour Party then going to vote against every single one of them, which sees £900 million of investment in local services? Where is the social justice in that absurdity?
Jackie Bailey.
Because it's interesting, because there are actually £170 million of cuts, £1.5 billion on the Deputy First Minister's watch. He has cut services. And you know, I watch him and the First Minister shake their head. The unfortunate thing for them is it is all true. They claim to be funding the health service. Well, we know across Scotland that the NHS is struggling. In NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, they will start to consult on the biggest cuts programme in their history, a staggering £105 million next year alone. Services will close, patients will suffer. And let me give you a flavour of that. Reduction in mental health services for older people. And here I thought mental health was supposed to be a priority for this government. Removal of school nurses from our schools. And of course, the closure of the children's ward at the RAH that the local member, George Adam, failed to mention. And that's not to mention the proposals to close the Vale and Inverclyde maternity units, which they won't tell us about until after the May election. How deeply cynical that is. So let's not pretend that this is anything else than a budget that cuts. And so to the SNP, no, I've given way to you already. Let me go to the SNP Green Deal. You might want to comment on that in a minute. Because I've watched these manoeuvres with fascination. They all say there's an extra 160 million on the table, but that is simply not true. The only new extra money is £29 million. The other money is already in the budget, it's underspend, it's shifting budget lines, it's accounting trickery. And like a cheap conjurer, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance reaches up his sleeve and pulls out another bankroll of money. And it's only for 1 year. So we start off next year with a £130 million cut. Can I say to the Greens as gently as I can, I think they've got very little out of this deal. I'm disappointed that progressive and principled politics has been abandoned for low politics and the illusion of influence. I think the SNP will be smiling tonight. They've played a blinder and they've played them well. Can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's announcement of 12.5% cap for the North East, the hospitality industry and renewables? But again, this isn't new money, and again, it's only for 1 year. What businesses want to know is, will they receive this relief next year? Or have we to wait and see what money he can pull from his other sleeve in 12 months' time? And that's not even to begin to touch on the additional impact there is for hospitals, for universities, for nurseries, for schools. And with the greatest respect, this is no way to run a budget. sleight of hand, short-termism, a complete failure to grasp the challenge ahead. Now, the Cabinet Secretary knows we raise a substantial proportion of our own income. The number of people paying tax in Scotland matters. It has a direct relationship with the amount we spend on public services. So we clearly need to grow the economy, to grow our tax base, to have more people in work, more people paying tax, the more you can spend on public services. It really is that simple. Yet at a time when our economy is stagnating, employment is down, unemployment is up, economic inactivity is rising, what do the SNP do? Well, you guessed it, Presiding Officer, they cut the budgets of their enterprise and skills agencies, the very bodies charged with growing our economy. And having cut the Scottish enterprise budget by 48%, they decide to give some of it back. And we've to welcome it. But you know, it's financial transaction money. It can only be used as loans that need to be repaid. And there's still a £50 million cut. Presiding Officer, Labour will not support grubby backroom deals among parties that are more interested in the next independence referendum than in growing the economy and investing in public services. This budget doesn't protect the poorest, it doesn't protect public services, it tinkers at the margins, it's timid, it lacks vision, and that's why we will vote against it at decision time.
Douglas Ross, around 8 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. As a new MSP, this is my first Stage 3 budget debate, so I can only surmise how they have occurred in the past. I assume when you get to this stage that there is very little new to add. That may have been the case in the past, before we got Derek Mackay, the Cabinet Secretary for U-turns. Now, I could have given Derek Mackay other titles, such as the Cabinet Secretary for the Parliament's Information Centre, given how often he deflected to spice any difficult questions over how his funding for additional business rates relief would take place. Or I could have named him the Cabinet Secretary for Money Trees and Cash Down the Back of the Sofa. Now, I accept that's not particularly catchy, but it does accurately describe how Derek Mackay has navigated his first budget. Long considered a rising star in the SNP, some must now be questioning his abilities. A finance secretary with over £500 million in real terms more to spend in this budget than his predecessor, but still, he can only manage to conjure up a budget that taxes hard-working families more, doesn't deliver for businesses, and cuts funding to local authorities while still expecting them to deliver more. Now, I will take an intervention.
Excuse me, Ms. Forbes.
Sorry.
Kate Forbes.
If the member is so concerned about cuts to local councils, how would he anticipate funding local councils if he is so determined to cut taxes for the rich?
Douglas Ross.
I'll come on to both funding for local councils and our tax proposals later, because I think they're important to give them the full amount of time. But we know the only way this budget will be passed tonight is through an alliance between the parties which support Scottish separation from the rest of the United Kingdom. So what of the Greens? Half of them are in the chamber at the moment. We know that Derek Mackay was shamefully described as a white knight by Richard Lockhead on Tuesday. So what could we call Patrick Harvey? Well, my colleague Murdo Fraser had his own choice description during the Stage 1 debate, but I have another description. They are pusillanimous. They lack courage. They're timid, and they give in too easily. We all remember Patrick Harvey telling the Chamber he hadn't negotiated enough from the SNP to meet his party's manifesto, which he'd been elected on just 9 months earlier, but he felt he had to do a deal. How the SNP and Derek Mackay must have laughed as the Green Party professed to wringing every last penny of concessions out of the SNP, only for another £44.6 million to be found for the business rates increases. I will give way to Mr.
Patrick Harvey.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. We know that the Tories' main concern is the refusal by the Scottish Government to cut taxes for the richest 10%. But does he at least acknowledge, as Mr. Goldman failed to, that people on that higher rate threshold are high earners? Mr. Goldman seems to think that £43,000 is a middle income. Does he not accept that the only people he's trying to protect are the richest 10% in society?
Douglas Ross.
I don't accept that, and I don't accept calling my colleague Maurice Golding Maurice Goldman. What I do say to Mr. Harvey is that this budget will suffer People will suffer as a result of this budget. Hard-working taxpayers will suffer as a result of this budget. And I think it's wrong for SNP and Green members who have pushed through this budget to try and profess any differently, because the public know that it will be hard-working families that will suffer because of the vote you are about to take. But I want to make a bit of progress if I can. I will try and come back if possible. But I want to ask a question of the Cabinet Secretary, if I may, on business rates. I did welcome the additional funding that he announced on Tuesday, and I'd like to raise a particular point on behalf of an operator of a bowling alley in Elgin. This bowling alley had previously a rateable value of £41,000 a year. It went up to £70,000, a 70% increase. Now, Darren Margach, the owner and the managing director, managed to get that back down through his own work to a 30% increase, but that is still a crippling increase. So can I just ask the Cabinet Secretary, since this bowling alley is also a restaurant and a bar, will they be included in the 12.5% cap? Because that is an important point I would like to get on the record. I'll give way to Mr. Mackay.
Derek Mackay.
Presiding Officer, what I think is inappropriate for me to do is to give individual tax advice to individual companies in the course of a Stage 3 debate. But what I would respond to do... Totally inappropriate, Presiding Officer, but what I would retort in saying is, why then are the Tories about to, in just a matter of minutes, about to vote against the relief package for tens of thousands of businesses across this land?
Douglas Ross.
I would say I'm grateful for that intervention, but I'm not. And if he wants to make it wider than just one business, can he then tell me why bowling alleys across Scotland saw a 20%, some of them a 20% reduction, but Darren Margach and Pins Bowling Alley in Elgin was a 30% increase? If you take them out, there's an overall decrease in business rates, but an increase when you include them. Now, I can't give way any further, but this is a genuine concern. Well, if you can answer that for Pins Bowling Alley in Elgin.
Derek Mackay.
Presiding Officer, as I've also said, by lowering the poundage for businesses, that is a tax reduction for businesses across the land. In addition to all the new national reliefs and the extension of the small business bonus, I've asked local authorities to look at what other areas they may wish to protect with the extra £160 million we've given to local authorities, and within that, the Conservatives need to step up to the plate and support local authorities in making those decisions.
Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I understand why the Cabinet Secretary won't give an answer here today, but it is a genuine concern I am raising. So I would appreciate, I will write to you and seek a full response for my constituent. However, we'll take a final look at Stage 1 before I move on. And Mr. Swinney, what I would say...
Mr. Ross, please sit down. Mr. Swinney, please sit down. If members wish to have a debate where there's no back chat, then please respect that. If all parties want to take part in that kind of heckling, then it's for me to decide when it's too much, not for anyone else. Mr. Ross.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. But I was reflecting on the Stage 1 proceedings, and just after that, SNP Cabinet Ministers, John Swinney included, went into tweet overdrive. They were hailing this deal they had done with the Greens, all of them saying how bad Labour and the Conservatives were for voting down the budget, and all of them with the same omission. And I looked at them, a number of them all failed to mention a different group in this Parliament. And who was it? It was the Liberal Democrats. They never got a mention in any of the tweets about the Stage 1 debate. So it got me wondering. I thought I must check the voting record of the Lib Dem MSPs, and they'd all also voted against the budget, so why were they not included in the criticism? And I began to wonder, was it because they're the smallest party in Parliament, or was it because the SNP are now worried that the Greens realise they've been short-sold on their deal and they'll need the Lib Dems to prop them up in the future? So I think that's very telling from the tweets we saw so far. I want to briefly mention... I will give way to Mr. Rennie.
Willie Rennie.
I don't really need Douglas Ross to stand up for me. What we really need is a change in the budget to deliver investment for the future. Is that something that he will support next time round?
Douglas Ross.
Well, Given how unsuccessful Mr Rennie was in his negotiations with the Scottish Government, I don't think I'll be taking any lectures from him as to how to go about budget negotiations in the future. But I do want to go... I don't even have time to go over a number of the points that were made. However, I'll make a couple of issues if I've got a bit more time, because I like to mention things that are said during the debate. Kate Forbes said it was a privilege to be a parliamentary liaison officer to the Cabinet Secretary, and now we all know why. She gets reports from the Cabinet Secretary before they're released to the rest of Parliament, puts out a press release, and no wonder she thinks it's a privilege if that is how she is dealing with her role. Presiding officer, this Stage 3 debate on the budget comes to a conclusion just now, and with it, the door closes on an unprecedented opportunity to grow Scotland's economy. And let us be clear, our economy is one that is underperforming. Tonight, the Greens and the SNP will make Scotland the highest tax part of the United Kingdom. But the reality is, Derek Mackay didn't need these tax rises at all. As Murdo Fraser pointed out during the Tuesday's debate on the Scottish rate resolution, the total being raised by creating this income tax differential is £108 million, substantially less than the £185 million the SNP had seemingly stashed away for a rainy day. Make no mistake about it, Scots can see past the smoke and mirrors of the SNP, and they want a strong opposition holding the government to account on decisions that will not only affect Scotland's bottom line, but their own. The Scottish Conservatives won't support the budget at decision time tonight, because it's a bad proposition for the people of Scotland. Bruce Crawford and Tom Arthur said this was a historic day. This budget is indeed historic, but it won't be remembered for the powers gained. It will be remembered for the opportunity lost.
I now call on Derek Mackay to close this debate until just before 5 o'clock, please, Mr Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I did say in earlier stages of the budget process that I would embark on a process of negotiations to find consensus in this chamber, and I feel as if I've done that, as this debate has evidenced. Well, not consensus for every part of the chamber to vote for the budget. Maybe that was too much to ask. I know I've been described as a magician, but maybe I'm not a miracle worker. To get the Better Together Alliance to vote with us to unlock extra investment for the public services of Scotland. Can I say many elements of this debate have actually been quite disappointing when you think about the seriousness of what we are discussing, which is all our public services, the tax rates that we are now responsible for. And I think this was an opportunity for us as a Parliament to show how we've matured and will respond to the powers that we have. And therefore, the most disappointing contribution in the chamber has to be Douglas Ross, who spent the summing up on behalf of the Conservatives to indulge in a large degree of personal insults and abuse. Surely, no Douglas, Douglas Ross, I'm sorry, if you choose to spend on behalf of the Conservatives your summing up time to simply insult me, then I think that does a disservice to your own party and the entire country. This budget was about £39 billion worth of services. That's what we have been discussing. And members across the chamber may find points of difference to oppose the budget on, but many members have been able to express reasons to support this budget and the choices that this Parliament would make. I would say to the Labour Party, I listened very closely to what the Labour Party and others wanted, and there were very specific requests that I'm trying to deliver as part of this budget process. You can describe them as U-turns if you want to, but the way I look at it, that in trying to listen to what parties in this chamber want, to try and respond to that, to build a budget that tries to build that consensus, felt like the right thing to do. Whether that was around attainment, I listened very carefully to what members in local government and in this parliament had said around our council tax proposition and how we should fund attainment. We increased the attainment fund to enhance what was proposed in our very own manifesto, and we changed how that resource would be raised, of course, to listen to voices within Parliament. And we also acted on rail fares and local service as well. But it looks as if the Labour Party, in a very dogmatic position, will still vote against the budget this evening. I give way to Kezia Dugdale.
and I thank the Minister for giving way. He will understand that our main opposition to the SNP's budget is their failure to use their tax powers. In the conversations that we had throughout the budget process, which I felt were very consensual and very worthwhile, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance said that he may be willing in future years to revisit the question of a higher top rate of tax. Is he still open to that? Can he tell us today?
Derek Mackay.
The Scottish Government has been very clear that we wouldn't take an unnecessary gamble with the additional rate. So yes, that policy is still under review, that we may revisit the additional rate. But we'll do so based on the evidence, and the First Minister has specifically instructed the Council of Economic Advisers to look at this issue, so that if we were to change the rate, we'll do what is intended, which is actually raise revenue for public services rather than jeopardise revenue for our public services. But in terms of the Liberal Democrats, I will touch upon the Liberal Democrats, just to say that I know, like many members of the opposition in this chamber, they might not be willing to vote for the budget, but I think all members of the opposition are willing this budget through this evening, because they know that this is a sensible and balanced budget to deliver for Scotland. The Greens have worked constructively, and I will return to that. One Conservative member, I forget which one it was, of course.
Willie Rennie.
I want to give the Finance Secretary another opportunity to abuse me to satisfy Douglas Ross. Can he just set out why he's not taken the opportunity to use the new tax powers to do something different on mental health and education? Why has he not done that?
Derek Mackay.
Well, we are using our new tax powers, but in a fair and balanced and proportionate way. We're not passing austerity on to the families of Scotland, and particularly the basic rate taxpayers, whilst at the same time investing an extra £900 million in our public services, spending more on the key areas that Willie Rennie asked me about. That includes police, that includes mental health, that includes NHS, and it specifically includes education in a way that I would have thought Willie Rennie would welcome. But I will not, have not, and don't intend to, in the future, abuse Willie Rennie or any other member of this chamber, because I don't think it's fitting of the seriousness of the subject that we are discussing. But in terms of the Conservatives, and it's always interesting when I turn my attention to the Conservatives, it always motivates the Labour Party to get involved. But in terms of the Tories, they have put in the public domain what the priorities were for this budget. And it actually wasn't education or police or enterprise or innovation or our international trade efforts or any of that whatsoever. I'll tell you what the requests from the Conservatives were. It was a tax cut for the biggest businesses. It was a tax cut for the higher value homeowners wanting to sell their house. And it was a tax cut for the top 10% of income earners in this country. That's the priority of the Conservatives, not those extra expenditure requests that many Conservatives make day after day, week after week. It was tax cuts for the richest in our society. That is not the choice this government will be making this evening.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. For the last opportunity to answer this point, if he won't listen to us, why will he not listen to the voice of the Scottish business community, who have told him time and time again to create a tax differential between Scotland and the rest of the UK is highly dangerous? Why won't he listen to them?
Derek Mackay.
The only people that they're saying has an impact of our policies are the Conservatives that are talking Scotland down. I do not believe there will be a mass exodus from Scotland as a consequence of our policies, especially when you look at the other side of the balance sheet and the social contract that we are delivering for our country around free education, no prescription charges, free personal care and lower council tax. These are the kind of areas that I think will encourage people to continue to live, work and invest in Scotland. You are most certainly not a branch of Scottish enterprise with your attitude towards this country. You are doing Scotland down whilst we are building Scotland up. There was criticism as well from the Conservatives on our Scottish growth scheme. It's been approved by the Treasury. It will be a sound scheme to support Scottish business. We revisited the tax argument, which was determined on Tuesday, which does beg the question, having determined our tax position on Tuesday, exactly what element is it of the £900 million of extra expenditure to the public services of Scotland do the Tories actually oppose and will be voting again this evening? But their hypocrisy has been shown on one issue above all else, and that is business rates, where this government took early action and then took further action to ensure that it was in place in advance of the new financial year. And I hear the Conservatives grumbling about 11th hour actions. The Chancellor is still to respond as to what he will do south of the border on business rates. And on business rate support, it was this government that lowered the poundage, increased the small business bonus threshold, lifting 100,000 properties out of rates altogether, and ensuring that 70% of businesses will pay no rates or lower rates as a consequence of our decisions. But as well as opposing all of that, the Tories at local level have also opposed local rates relief schemes as well. So we can hear the noise that comes from the Tories. They may make a lot of noise, but they don't make a difference when it comes to the decisions of our country. And that is where the Greens have made a constructive contribution to the budget setting of this country. See, the Tories are for tax rises, but only if you're poor or if you're sick or you're seeking education. You're quite happy to raise and charge taxes in those areas. You may well be a strong opposition, but tonight you'll be opposing. Oh yes, a strong opposition, strongly opposing the police, strongly opposing the NHS, strongly opposing the extension of childcare, strongly opposing more support for business, and strongly opposing connectivity, as well as a new skills fund. They are a strong opposition to the good ideas that are coming from this government and this parliament. Presiding officer, some have said there was no support for this budget. Well, I'll mention, since the Conservatives don't want to hear from me, but others who have commented on this budget, such as the Chair of Colleges Scotland, who said, "The increased investment in Scotland's colleges is very welcome indeed, particularly in these tough financial times." Or Liz Cameron from the Chambers of Commerce. "We are pleased that the key infrastructure budgets, such as roads and digital infrastructure, are set to rise substantially in the coming year." Or the EIS, who said that they welcomed the announcement of additional investment to support schools in the area. Or the FSB, who said, "By giving full rates relief to 100,000 Scottish firms, the government has lifted the prospects of smaller businesses facing a tough 2017. And further, on the new skills fund, FSB said, "We called for a new flexible fund to help firms develop their skills, especially the ones that they need to tap the power of the digital economy." So what was announced today? Well, we need to see the details. Sounds like it fits the bill perfectly. And finally, from CBI, Hugh Aitken, he said, "The commitments in this budget on housing and digital and transport connectivity will lay the foundations to allow firms to get on with growing our economy and creating jobs for the long term." Presiding officer, I think that Bruce Crawford very helpfully covered the points of the economic incoherence of the Conservative Party, who every time when asked how they would meet any new spending commitment, said they would either how they would spend the resources. Now, Murdo Fraser is heckling me at the moment, but maybe I'll recap his economic madness. You know, they promised me a new economics book, and all I get is daft dossiers from the Conservatives, which normally begin with inaccurate figures. They said to fund their policies, they would re-spend money that's already been spent, or with a status quo tax policy, that would magically increase their revenues, which you could retrospectively spend at the start of a financial year based on future economic growth. That is the economic madness of the Conservatives. So I won't take your advice in economics, and I won't take the advice of the Labour Party on how to run a budget. Let's just look at Clackmannanshire, whose administration faced a budget decision today. The Labour leader resigned, the whole administration resigned, and they have no budget, so I won't take any lessons from the Labour Party on how to run a budget. In my final minute, presiding officer, can I say that this is a budget that's good for Scotland, investing an additional £900 million in our public services, record investment in the NHS, expanding childcare, more to tackle the attainment gap in our schools, more support for colleges, more investment in infrastructure, expanding broadband and supporting our business environment. This is a budget of which I am proud, and I urge every member to support it this evening.
Thank you. Tavis Scott first paper.
Planning Officer, a government's review into public bodies subjected to the Scottish Government School Review was published this afternoon. It makes recommendations on the High Board and indeed on others. As you know, Presiding Officer, Parliament has already voted to retain High's Strategic Decision Making Board. The proposals now in front of Parliament would change that. In light of Parliament's vote, have you had any indication that government would wish to make a statement on this matter, given the vote that we've already had?
Can I thank Mr Scott for the point of order? I'm actually going to address that point imminently, given that it was raised by Rhoda Grant earlier this afternoon. Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to raise a point of order under Standing Order 7.3. I seek your guidance after Gail Ross, during the debate that's just completed, twice called Edward Mountain a liar in relation to the concerns he was raising about maternity cover at Caithness General Hospital. When I raised this during the debate, the Deputy Presiding Officer and her officials said they hadn't heard it, but will you seek confirmation from the member that she did, in fact, use that word twice to allow that issue to be dealt with? And if not, will you check the audio and the visual recordings of this meeting, which will show that even her colleagues sat next to her were concerned about the language she used?
Thank you. Thank you for both points of order. If I could just address both in turn. Point of order, Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Under Rule 7.3 of the Standing Orders, I seek your guidance on comments made by Kezia Dugdale today at First Minister's Questions. Kezia Dugdale said that I couldn't even be bothered to respond to the public consultation on paediatric services in the Royal Alexander Hospital. I have this afternoon received a letter of apology from NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde that due to an administrative oversight, my submission was not included in the report. In this age of alternative truths, I'm sure that Kezia Dugdale would not wish to put petty political point scoring ahead of the facts. Can the Presiding Officer advise whether Kezia Dugdale will be given the opportunity to correct the record on this matter?
Thank you. So, thank you, Mr. Adam, for your point of order. That's not a point of order, however, it is a point. The member was named in the debate earlier. He's had now the point to correct and put his point of view, and that will be noted by all. It's not a point of order for me to rule on. Can I move to the two other points of order, the one raised by Tavish Scott and earlier by Rhoda Grant? Rhoda Grant raised a point about the publication of Lauren Creerer's Enterprise and Skills Review, and I've looked into this matter further. I understand that the Cabinet Secretary wrote to the convener of the Enterprise Jobs and Fair Work Committee just after 2:30 p.m. today, and the report has now been placed in Spice. The news release Rhoda Grant referred to was issued more than 30 minutes beforehand. The Scottish Government will be aware that there has been significant interest in this issue across all parties, and in those circumstances, I would expect the Government to make all members aware of its publication at the same time. And I would invite the Cabinet Secretary... I would invite the Cabinet Secretary... I can't see, but I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to consider this or to reflect on this. Bureau members will also be aware, however, that the Cabinet Secretary has undertaken to come back to Parliament on this issue in due course, and so there's an expectation that members will have the opportunity to question the Cabinet Secretary or to discuss this issue further. On the second... Well, if I may, Mr. Johnson, I'll just finish these points of order and then I'll take a fourth point of order. On Mr. Ross's point of order, I understand, and I have been following, I was in for the early part of the debate, and I've been following the debate, and I understand it is a heated debate, and that members' emotions are running high. The presenting officer who was in the chair, and the clerks, neither of them heard the remarks referred to. I would just take this opportunity to remind all members to treat each other with courtesy and respect, and not to make personal remarks or use unparliamentary language. Mr. Johnson.
Your confirmation that Kate Forbes released the information 30 minutes prior to its placing with Spice, would you consider that 4.11 of the Ministerial Code has been breached, where it states explicitly that PLOs are required to exercise care in the use of any official information to which they have access in the course of their duties as a PLO?
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Again, that's not a point of order. The Ministerial Code is a matter for the Minister and for the First Minister and the Government. However, I have made my views known and I expect the Minister to reflect on the matter. Are there any further points of order? Thank you. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that Amendment 4168.2 in the name of Murdo Fraser, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Derek Mackay on the Budget Scotland, be agreed. Are we all agreed? No. We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 4168.2 in the name of Murdo Fraser is yes 31, no 94. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The final question is that motion 4168 in the name of Derek Mackay on the Budget Scotland Bill be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 4168 in the name of Derek Mackay is yes 68, no 57. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed. And the Budget Scotland Bill is passed. That concludes decision time. I now close this meeting of Parliament.